well to all of you. Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullah. Very nice to see you. How are you, young man? You're looking younger. Allahu Akbar.
I'm just going, Sheikh, you know.
Why are you going?
I'm just going to collect my children.
Okay, bring them back here.
MashaAllah, Sheikh.
Yeah, Allah bless you. Nice to see you. Alaykum as-salam. Nice to see you. Alaykum as-salam. It's very beautiful to see all of you, and I'm glad that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is easing the situation for all of us so that we can come back together. And I hope in this lockdown for the last maybe 15 months across the world, not just in one country or one space, people have learned the lesson that unity is so important. Standing together, being close to one another, being sympathetic, being caring, having a conscious, supporting one another, giving a hand to those who are beneath you, lifting people up, smiling in their faces, all those things that are supposed to be happening in the world, unfortunately, we neglected them and we became selfish and self-centered. We became very foolish and naive and we became very arrogant. And Allah has brought a test to bring us back. The question for myself personally, what have I learned? Every day I'm asking myself, what have I learned? I haven't been anywhere. This is the first time in my life I'm locked in. I have been traveling all over the place. I have been going everywhere. I never sit at home for a day. And every day I'm out. But for 15 months now, I can count the number of times I'm out. So please take this very seriously. The message is not being said for no reason. There is a very good reason. And the people who know what is going on, they will never speak out. They will just keep quiet. Because at a time whereby everybody is claiming to be the truth, everybody is claiming to be right, and everybody is claiming to know everything and everything, those who know the truth and understand the truth and they know where they come from, they will not say nothing. They will leave it up to us. So my advice, think seriously and follow the rules. And it's going to be eased out for you now. There is almost an ease now. You're all sitting, mashallah, comfortably here with me. But take it easy. Because you don't know what's going to happen next. Nobody was expecting this to happen. We were in Morocco having our retreat. We came back and everything started. And suddenly it was like fire. Everywhere it is. And believe me, I will say this, and I don't need to repeat it. This is just the beginning. If this is a beginning of the sign of the terrible time, this is just the beginning, because this is nothing. There will be even more difficult time to come. But inshallah, Allah will sort it out. Before I start my topic for today, two things I want to mention. Number one, thank you very much indeed for supporting Rumi's Cave. Rumi's Cave is an idea that we want people to find an alternative space to come to without any restriction or difficulties, for people to be able to live, to be themselves in a secure environment through the application of our understanding of the true meaning of the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whereby we have nothing. In this society we live with, they have their own means of bringing a space to people, like the pubs and the bars. And you see, look now, they were most happiest for the lifting of the lockup because the pubs are open. I don't blame them. This is their environment because that's where they meet. But where our people meet? The masjid is not a place for meeting. It's a place restricted by people who open them only for what they think fitting, and that's it. And astaghfirullah, a masjid, yes, for salah, for sujood, but it should not be the building. It should be the place within that building for salah, like Masjid Rasulullah sallam. The Mosque of the Prophet ﷺ used to be a place, a space for everybody and everyone. The Muslim, the non-Muslim, the hypocrite, the evildoer, the staunch believer, the right and the left and the center, they're all there. And the Prophet never questioned anyone. You are this or you are that, or pointing fingers. Today we live in a world where if there are people who will test your iman, will ask you whether you are a Salafi or a Sufi, will ask you whether you are Tablighi or whatever. All this nonsense. There's no place for this. So we wanted to retain back the Sunnah by having an open space. You come with your niqab or hijab, you come with your beard or clean shaven, you come, as long as you come and follow the environment that we are building for you, we have no question. This is the way it should be. If somebody said this is pre-mixing, they don't understand what pre-mixing means. It's tawaf pre-mixing. There is no place whereby you will be more mixed with women and men, young and old, together, touching one another than tawaf in Kaaba. But if your place there is thinking that it's pre-mixing, you shouldn't be there. Find another place, because your mind is polluted. Your heart is camouflaged with saying that they should not be there. So please think of what I'm saying. Today's subject will fit truly with this. I was asked to speak about this. I spoke about it before. But today I'm going to speak about it again in a different kind of way. Al-ru'ya. Al-ru'ya. Al-ru'ya is a word in Arabic. In English, it doesn't have an expansion of giving you a proper meaning for it. But they say it is dream. A dream in Arabic, meaning hulm. And hulm literally meaning that which comes from your own instinct, from your own desire, from your own mind, which is not really something that you can hold on to. Wishy-washy kind of thoughts that are translated in what you call in English a dream you see at night. It could be something good, or it could be something bad, or it could be a nightmare. But in Arabic, it's called ru'ya. Ra'a, yara, ru'yatan. So my talk is about a ru'ya, okay? I'm going to ask myself, what is it? What is ru'ya? And what is hulm? And what's the difference between them? What is the importance of the ru'ya that we see? And who is the person who's supposed to see this ru'ya? Because there are some people going around, only the pious people can see ru'ya. Rubbish. This is nonsense. Allah is just. If somebody doesn't know anything, and he is the most evil person, Allah will not deprive them from his mercy. The evilest people, Allah, within his role as Ar-Rahman, he must sustain them. And a part of your sustenance is to have a ru'ya, is to see, whether in your dream or while you are awake. That is Allah's provision for all of us. And then the last thing I will talk about is tafsir al-ru'ya, explaining it, and who is fit to explain it, and what the advice of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam about it. Now, the word ru'ya has come in the Quran 4 times. In 4 surahs, Surah Yusuf, Surah Al-Isra, Surah Al-Saffat, Wal-Fath. Yusuf, Wal-Isra, Wal-Saffat, Wal-Fath, 4 surahs. But according to us in the Islamic area of understanding this subject, there are 2 meanings for ru'ya. A ru'ya while you are asleep, and a ru'ya while you are awake. When you take it in this way, in English, the most fitting word for it is a vision, not a dream. A vision. So a vision is that which you actually can capture and see while you are awake with your eyes, and while you are asleep with your inner eye. That's the idea. So I want you to understand it, not to confuse it, because a dream doesn't mean ru'ya. Vision means ru'ya. Have you seen a vision? Yes. Because a vision is something that you can actually see in front of you, whether you are awake or asleep. So we have got people today living in the world, they have vision while they're awake. I know many people like that. They see a vision. And you could be now sitting with me here, and you could have a vision. Just you, like a television screen in front of you. You see what is going to happen, or what has happened. It will be very short, very vivid, and very sharp. And I will tell you some of those in my talk, inshallah. Ru'ya come from the word ra'a. Ra'a meaning to see or so. Ra'a, yara, ru'yatan. So that's where it comes from in Arabic. And in English, if I want to really give it a proper understanding, is to look. So you have to visualize what you are seeing in front of you, or to see, not I think. I have seen, and I know what I have seen. Or to view, all those words becomes ru'ya. And as I said, vision, the best interpretation. And it is one out of 46 part of prophecy. If you take a prophecy and divide it by 46 part, your vision that is clear, whether you are sleeping or awake, is just 1/46 of a prophecy. Imagine how powerful the prophecy is. That means the heart of the one who is receiving the prophecy is 46 times powerful than yourself. Seriously. And a prophet, by the way, in ranking to the higher ranking of people who become messengers and those who are in the higher ranking of messengerhood, is very low, like primary. If a primary prophecy is that powerful, we are nothing. Seriously, we are nothing. And this one who see a vision that is 1/46 of a prophecy, they are only seeing it that their heart is able to carry. Hence, a lot of people who see this kind of vision occasionally, that means they are not ready all the time. The luckiest people who are occasionally seeing, but more luckiest, those who are always seeing. If you are not seeing, you need to question yourself why. If suddenly your telephone you are carrying in your hand is not receiving, either the battery is dead or it is being cut off from the provider. So you need to check what's happening. So here, for you, you need to check your heart by muhasaba, or you need to check your link with the teaching that you are receiving. You understand me? Because where you receive your knowledge is like the company that is providing, okay, the internet or the telephone service in your mobile phone. And your heart is like checking your own equipment. So before you tell the provider what's wrong, you look, check your telephone first. Maybe something is wrong, the battery needs charging. You can't waste your time. So is your heart all right? And we'll talk about those who really connected, why their heart are ready. Now we come to Al-Hulm. Al-Hulm is what you call in English dream. People say this is just a dreamer. Meaning, he just carries his own thoughts and ideas and keep dreaming. Keep thinking it is true. When you look in English for the word hulm, it really means to imagine from your own imagination. It's a fantasy, something that you have been always hoping, and there is nothing. But in reality, it's false, because not coming from the world of truth. It's coming from your nafs, from your ego. Something initiated by your own nafs. Hence, you're not quite sure about it. You can't remember it well. It is wishy-washy. It is like little bits of an advert cut pieces and they don't really gel together. You see yourself running, then suddenly you see yourself locked in a cupboard, then suddenly you see yourself jumping a mountain, then suddenly you see yourself becoming a kitten. Doesn't make sense. What's this? It's not a vision. This is your nafs playing a game, and there are reasons for why people who have dreams, they see dreams, they don't see visions. You leave me today, and if you have dreams, you need to work on your nafs, because where it comes from, it doesn't come from the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your nafs is making those things, and I'll show you that. Let us explain from the Quran what ru'ya really mean. In Surah Al-Isra, verse 60, and for those who go and revise and read, verse 60 in Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا الرُّؤْيَا الَّتِي أَرَيْنَاكَ إِلَّا فِتْنَةً لِلنَّاسِ. Allah is addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's saying to him, We did not show you the vision we have shown you only as a fitna for people, not for the believers or the Muslims. Whom Allah is addressing here? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The story goes, before he went to Badr Wells, you know Badr when you go to Medina, outside Medina, quite far away, 100, maybe 50 kilometers, something like that, far away, there is these wells where the Prophet went and waited for the mushrikeen, and the first battle of showing their power and defending themselves took place. When he arrived there, where he has seen the vision of what is to happen, he was pointing out openly where people will die. And he said in his own words, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a long hadith, you find in Imam Muslim Sahih, I'm not going to quote it, and Abu Dawood radiallahu ta'ala anhu aydan, and they say, ورد أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما نزل ماء بدر. It is reported that when the Prophet came down to the wells of Badr, he pointed out with his finger to certain places. هذا مصرع فلان. Here where so and so will die. Here so and so will die. Here so and so will die. The mushrikeen, when they heard about this, they start mocking him. Because they all think he's crazy. He's mad. He's inspired. But yes, he's inspired by his own inflated ego and the jinns that come and inspire him. Or Iblis himself. Imagine how insulting they used to beat the Prophet. Did he lift his finger to point to anybody? Did he call any of them, you are a hypocrite, you are a kafir? Never. Although today people who claim to be believers, they do this. Islam is not about pointing fingers and doing gestures and swearing or fighting or arguing. It doesn't fit a Muslim. Your generation need to come down, if you are really thinking the truth, to move away from that. Because the world today, as you say, is all coming together like a small place. Everything you see is somehow under the umbrella of what we call in Arabic fahsha, that which is obscene, swearing, insulting, demeaning, everything. And everybody wants to fight. The Muslim doesn't do that. When the Prophet was asked, describe to us the Muslim, he said, the one whom the others are safe from their tongue and their hands. But today, if I'm safe from your hand, I will not be safe from your tongue. You could see it in the car rage. You could see it in the park rage. And now the summer coming, everybody is fighting, everybody is arguing. Even some of the younger generation I see in Mecca, in Medina, they are doing the same thing. Doesn't make sense. You can never improve yourself or await Allah to improve you until you improve yourself by looking at the example of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Okay? Some of the weak believers, they were also having doubt. But subhanAllah, Allah made the dream that they thought it was into a vision that came true. They thought the Prophet was just speaking from his mind. He was inspired by his ego and the shayateen around him and the jinn inspiring him. But Allah said, no, it's a vision. Hence, the Quran, when it spoke, it says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا الرُّؤْيَا الَّتِي أَرَيْنَاكَ. We do not make this vision that we have made you see, إِلَّا fitna. Only as a means of test, to test them. Whether they trust you or not, whether they are going to respect you or not, whether they are going to stand and say things against you. And they did. The weak ones among the believers, and the hypocrites, and the mushrikeen, they did. But then, it came true. The battle took place, and exactly, not 1 millimeter from where he pointed out, those people who will die, they died. Exactly the way he saw it. And that is what we call a ru'ya or a vision. It comes exactly as it is being seen. Number two, another example. In Surah Al-Fath, verse 27. This is the opening of Mecca or the conquest of Mecca. At the beginning of the Surah, Allah speaks about the conquest. إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. But then in verse 27, Allah said, لَغَصَّدَغَ اللَّهُ رَسُولَهُ الرُّؤْيَا بِالْحَقِّ. لَغَصَّدَغَ اللَّهُ رَسُولَهُ الرُّؤْيَا بِالْحَقِّ لَتَدْخُلُنَّ الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامَ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ. Allah has made sure that the vision the Prophet saw of him and his companion entering Mecca and going around the Kaaba making tawaf, by Allah's will, it will take place. InshaAllah. SubhanAllah, the Prophet told everybody in Medina, Abshiru, Good tidings to all of you, I have seen a vision. You might ask, he is the prophet. Jibreel comes to him all the time. Why does he have to see a vision? Why didn't Jibreel come and tell him about going to Mecca? No. A vision, literally, as I said earlier on, is a part of inspiration by Allah, and it becomes a part of the wahi. A part of the wahi. The Quran is wahi. The speech between Allah and the servants is wahi. And a part of it is a vision. So that to prove to all of us, not only the Prophet can have, every human can have this because Allah is just. But they were chosen to be prophets, and we can be exalted in our stations by following their examples. So Allah has brought to be true what the Prophet have seen, that him and his companion will enter the Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, inshallah. They went to Mecca with the intention of entering it the first time. Aam al-Hudaybiyah. If you remember the Sulh of Hudaybiyah, the treaty between the Mushrikeen and the Prophet ﷺ, when they wanted to enter and they said, no, not this year, next year. And the Prophet made peace between them and himself. And subhanAllah, look at the wisdom of Rasulullah ﷺ. Even when they were writing the treaty, Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib says, the Prophet was asking me to write, I was so excited. I wrote, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the compassionate, the merciful. And the Mushrikeen said, no. We don't want that. Who's the Rahman al-Rahim? They know, but they want to show that they are superior. The Prophet said, what do you want? Bismik Allahumma. Allahumma in Arabic, literally meaning by all glorious names. When you say Allahumma, you are asking Allah by his all names. Those you know and those you don't know. The Prophet said to Ali, write it. Ali said, but. He said, no, but. Write it. Look at the ease and the mercy and the gentleness. Today we don't do these things. There are lessons to be learned from this kind of thing that the Prophet did in his life. Don't be too strict with yourself or people you are dealing with, whether it is your partner in marriage or your children or your neighbors or your employees working with you, your colleagues, whatever. Always remember the Prophet ﷺ was sent as a mercy, and if you are his follower, you will show mercy. For if you don't, you will never be shown mercy, as the Prophet said in the hadith. So they wrote the agreement, they came back. Some of the believers became a little bit worried. The Prophet told us we're going to enter and make tawaf. What is this? They had doubt. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because he's not the kind of person who will conceal what he feels inside, he came to the Prophet and said to him, Ya Rasulullah, what's going on? And I will quote exactly what he said. He radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفَلَمْ تَكُنْ تُخْبِرُنَا أَنَّا تَنَأْتِ الْبَيْتَ وَنَطُوفُ بِهِ. Didn't you told us before we came that we will come to the house and go around it in tawaf? Qala bala. The Prophet doesn't lie. He said, of course I did. Afa akhbartuka annaka ta'tihi 'amak hadha? But did I tell you you will come this year? Umar did not understood the wisdom of Allah in the verse itself. Because Allah said, inshaAllah. When you say inshallah, it's open-ended. There is no date in it. There is no strict time in it. Did I ask you or told you that we're going to come this year? What did Umar say? La. Umar radiallahu ta'ala said, la. Qala Rasulullah, فَإِنَّكَ آتِيهِ وَمُطَّوْفٌ بِهِ. Then you are going to come and you're going to make tawaf. The Prophet interpreted his dream as exactly it way it happened. They came the year after and they made the tawaf around the Kaaba. And the dream or the vision became true. Why? Because Allah said, inshallah. If Allah willed it, if Allah doesn't will it, it will never take place. And the dream or the ru'ya will come true. Example number 3. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم قد صدقت الرؤيا إنا كذلك نجزي المحسنين. This is in Surah As-Saffat, verse 105. Surah As-Saffat, 105. This is a very beautiful occasion to prove that a vision can take place exactly the way you see it. And the greater the vision, the greater the happening. Here Allah is talking about Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. He saw a vision 3 times. And the same vision, Allah is talking to him directly. O Ibrahim, your son Ismail has come to an age, if you truly love us, sacrifice him for our sake. He wakes up, his teaching is, you don't kill. For killing one human, as if you kill the whole humanity. To the extent that Iblis comes to his wife Hajar and said to her, did you know what your husband has been dreaming or been seeing in his vision? What? And he will tell her. And she will know that it is Iblis. How? Because she will tell him, if he saw it, he saw it because he will not see but what Allah inspired him to see. He comes to his son Ismail. The same thing, Ismail pushed him away. That's why we do the Jamarat when we go. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, the day came, the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, the day of Arafah, he took his son, they stayed there. On the morning of the sacrifice, on the 10th, he put his son and tied him up and got his knife to slaughter him. But because Allah did not intend for him to kill his son, Allah did not want the son to be sacrificed. Allah only wanted to prove to him that what you saw is from me, number one. And number two, you must adhere to my teaching. Whether you like it or not, follow it. For this end, Allah said in the Quran, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. And perhaps you dislike something, but it's going to be good for you. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. So although Ibrahim disliked slaughtering the only son he had at that time, but he knows, مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَىٰ. Whatever is with Allah is better and forever will remain, inshallah. Allah says to him, because you have fulfilled what you have seen in your vision, which is a commandment. And by the way, sometimes the vision is telling you to do something, asking you to do something. And sometimes it's just something to direct you or to point out to you, something to correct or to avoid or to be aware of, or just to see, to understand the wisdom from it. That's the idea. So his vision here is telling him to do something, therefore he has to do it to prove what he has seen in the true vision. Why Ibrahim did that? Because he is always obedient to Allah. He has always depended upon Allah. He has always turned to him and nobody else. Even when he was thrown into the fire and Jibreel was sent to him and asked to help him. Oh Allah, you have sent me to your servant to help him, I will do. And he came. Assalamu alaikum Ibrahim, wa alaikum assalam, assalam yughrik assalam. Allah assalam is telling you assalamu alaikum ya Ibrahim. And anything you require will be done. I am here for you. And his response, aminka am indillah, it is from you the help will come or from Allah? It is from me. أَمَخْلُوقٌ أَنْتَ أَمْ خَالِقٌ. Are you a created being or a creator? He said, I'm a created being like you. He said, then اخصى عني. I don't need you. Go away from me. I need him. Look at where Ibrahim is and where we are. The Quran is not just to be read. The Quran is to be reflected upon. And the most important message in the Quran is Tawheed. Unfortunately, the people who are carrying the banner of Tawheed among the people who are trying to teach the people to bring them back to Tawheed, they are not taking it the right way, they are taking it in the harsh way. Although Allah wants the Tawheed message to be gentle and kind and merciful, lenient, with a gentle speech. وَادْعُوا إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَدِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ. And invite people to the way of thy Lord by the most gentle possible way. Even Fir'aun, the most evilest of men in his time, Allah said to Musa, اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طقى. Go to Fir'aun, for it is he who has become a tyrant, an oppressor, an evil doer, and claim to be God. Don't beat him up, Don't tell him off. Don't kill him. وَقُلْ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. And speak to him gently. Be lenient and soft with him. Although today we hear some people saying to you, oh, this mushrikeen, oh, this Muslim is a bid'ah man, let us beat him up. What is this nonsense? Where does it come from? So we need to understand the Quran in the way Allah speaks. The Prophet says, I have left you two things. If you hold tight onto them, you will never go astray. The book, the Quran and the Sunnah. Not the Quran of our own imagination and interpretation, and not the Sunnah that we falsely interpret to suit ourselves. It must suit the Prophet way. من لم يكن هواه تبعا لما جاءت به, the one who his desire is not following my desire or that which I brought, he's not one of mine. The Prophet says صلى الله عليه وسلم. So we need to come back and understand that. So Sayyidina Ibrahim عليه السلام, when he put his son for the slaughter, he said to his son first, imagine, يا بني إني أرى في المنام أني أذبحك. Oh my son, I have seen in my sleep that I sacrifice you. No complaint. Nothing. You are crazy, you are mad, or trying to run away from his father. Because he already knows as well. He's inspired as well. He has seen dreams himself or visions. So what happened is, straight away, he said, Ya Abati Ba'al Ma Tumar, oh father, do what you have been commanded. فلما أسلما, when they both surrender to the will of Allah, fulfilling the vision, وتله للجبين, and he put him to his side and about to slaughter him, فديناه بذبح عظيم, Allah said, we have saved him, and in his place we brought a great sacrifice. Allah brought a sacrifice from the heaven, and it was sacrificed in his place. And that is where a ru'ya comes, a vision, a clear vision of seeing exactly what he should do, and he exactly wanted to do it. So when you see a vision telling you to do something, don't take it lightly. Do it. And I promise you, you will get exactly what the vision is telling you. Now come to hulum. Haluma yahlamu hulman. Haluma yahlamu hulman. Literally meaning, it is something that which inspired by your own ego for many different reasons, and one of them is your inclination towards fulfilling what your ego wants. And in Surah At-Tur, verse 32, Allah says, أَمْ تَأْمُرُهُمْ أَحْلَامَهُمْ بِهَذَا, or perhaps their own delusions from their own egos are commanding them to do or say this. أَمْ تَأْمُرُهُمْ أَحْلَامُهُمْ بِهَذَا. Literally, the Mufassirin say, it is saying here, أَيْ أَنَّ عَقُولُهُمْ تَأْمُرُهُمْ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ مِنَ الْأَكَاذِيبِ وَالْأَبَاطِيلِ وَالزُّورِ. That means their inspiration come from their own ill egos, which is fabricated by their own thoughts, full of lies and full of falsehood, and that which does not fit what they claim to be a vision. It's coming from themselves. So Allah is distinguishing to us that the difference between a ru'ya and a hulm, a ru'ya min ar-Rahman, it's a provision of sustenance for the spiritual well-being from Allah. Who? Ar-Rahman. Who's Ar-Rahman? That the whole surah in the Quran, Ar-Rahman. Allama al-Quran. The one who taught the Quran. Khalaq al-insan. The one who created man. Allamahu al-bayan. And he taught men how to understand whatever they need to understand of living their life here, to create for themselves a passage for the hereafter, inshaAllah. But then when you don't understand that, he said, Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman, fas'al bihi khabira. Ar-Rahman, if you don't really know, ask somebody who has the experience of knowing who he is. And according to the Prophet ﷺ, Ar-Rahman is the name through which all that which comes to us in this world, ad-dunya, come from it. Ar-Rahman. Ar-Rahman is the one who sustains all the creation. Ar-Rahman, who is giving everything that he created in this lower world a life. Ar-Rahman, through which all needs of all creation that we know of or not is sustained. Ar-Rahman. Very beautiful name. Okay? And there is a lot of benefit in reciting it. But Ar-Rahim, on the other side, is only for the hereafter. And the Prophet said this clearly in a hadith. He says, if you take rahmah, mercy, as one unit and divide it into 200 components, one unit become a Rahman for this world. And 99 unit from the mercy will be for Ar-Rahim in the hereafter. And Rahim is going to be showing that mercy in the day of judgment for those who have faith. If you have no faith, you receive no rahmah. But in this world, through Ar-Rahman, Al-Kafir wal-Fajir, the hypocrites and the non-believer, the atheist, the one who rejects, the one who insults, the one who does everything, is sustained. Looked after. People in Las Vegas, although they are openly denying God his teaching of gambling and doing all the evil things, they're living life of Jannah to people of dunya. It's Jannah. When they go to Las Vegas, oh. Seriously, the way they feel, this is like going to Mecca. So we need to be very careful. So Allah does not in any way take away from his mercy that he has created them. They will receive it. If your neighbor is driving the best car and you are driving an old banger, don't complain. This is your lot. Allah is testing you. You believe in me. You trust in me, I'm giving you this old car. He doesn't believe in me. He insults me. I'm going to give him the best car. Are you going to be jealous? Are you going to question Allah? Are you going to say, why me? Like all of us, oh, I did everything, but I failed. I pray every day, but I don't get anything I want. MashaAllah. You pray for what? You pray for Allah, you pray for yourself. Don't really be naive. Wallahi al-azim. A lot of the problem you are passing through today, if the people of the past who have nothing of the ease you have today in information and technology and transport, they didn't have anything. Even when I go back to my own childhood, we didn't have these things you have today. We could have excelled in spirituality. You have everything, but something is holding you back. What is it? I'm asking myself, I'm pulling my hair. Something is holding you back. What is holding you back is your own ego. You don't have to look far. أعدى عدوك نفسك التي بين جنبك. The worst of your enemy is your nafs that is between your two sides. Don't point finger to anybody. But when you look at us, oh, it is Israel, it is America, it is this. What about us? Where do we fall in the equation? Iblis will come in the day of judgment, although we blame him a lot, he will say, ولا تلوموني. Do not blame me, but blame yourself. Blame yourself. So I blame myself. You need to blame yourself. We need to work on the self. We need to make sure that our egos are under control, not they are controlling us, so we are misled and misguided. Okay? Therefore, the difference between a ru'ya, that it is from Ar-Rahman, and a hulm, which is from shaitan. Why is it from shaitan? Because not true. It's not true. A dream is not really true. A dream, yani when somebody is talking about, I'm going to do this, I'm going to, you say, please don't keep dreaming. It means it's not real. A dream is not real. But a vision is real because you have seen it and Allah will make it come true, whether you will see it in your lifetime or after your lifetime, people will see it. What is ru'ya? Wahyun wa istilhamun yu'inu al-insan. A vision is an inspiration from Ar-Rahman to guide and to help the human being. Not just the Muslim or the believer. Anybody who says good dreams are only for the believers. Even the believers themselves, some brothers say, who are you? When somebody comes to you and says, oh, by the way, last night I saw a beautiful vision. I saw Rasulullah, astaghfirullah al-azim. Don't say that. Why not? If he saw the Prophet, he saw the Prophet. Are you jealous? How could you? Oh, but You're not even wearing a hijab. How could you see the Prophet? Oh, you're not even having a beard. Oh, you don't even pray your five. Who told you so? Who told you this nonsense? We Muslims are the worst enemies to ourselves. And especially with the ease of the media, we are passing information through this terrible platform you are using, which most of it is rubbish. Even when we have the book, I have books, I don't read from the internet. But even in the books, I have to make sure the book is authenticated. The book is well read and established with the right creed in it. Not any rubbish, because without Tawheed, you get nowhere. If it is anything to do with other than Allah, it's not going to benefit you. Now, what's the importance of having a vision? I will say, it will clarify for the seer what is taking place in life, generally, or in personally their life or somebody whom they know. And it will bring a clear indication where you might be. For example, you intend to travel. You didn't make istikhara to travel, although istikhara is a must, we'll talk about it at the end. But then suddenly, you see a vision. And in that vision, you see yourself have traveled to this place and you find yourself there. What it means really, whatever you saw in that vision, it's going to come true. If it is straightforward. Because sometimes the vision is not straightforward. Sometimes the vision is giving you a glimpse of what needs to be interpreted to be the exact thing that you want. And we will talk about this in a minute. Okay? Surah Yusuf is the surah of dreams and the surah of visions. Dreams, because the people of Egypt who did not believe in Allah, they used to think of dreams. They were thinking of dunya, running after it, and doing everything to fulfill their desires that their egos are pushing them towards. But it is also a surah of visions, because in it, it shows you everyone can see a vision. So Yusuf alayhi salam, as a child, he saw his vision that the surah speaks about from the beginning to the end. And what a beautiful vision. The Aziz, the ruler of Egypt, he saw a vision. According to his people, it is ahlam. It is just wishy-washy collection of imaginary kind of false thing that the ruler has seen. They did not understand. And the prisoners who entered with Yusuf the same day he entered the prison, two of them, they have seen vision, and others in the prison have seen. Now let us look at it. To prove that everyone can see a vision, and all those visions can come true, if only we understand where do they come from. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, the companion and the cousin of Prophet says, Ru'ya al-Anbiya wahi. The vision of the prophets is an inspiration. No prophet will see a vision just as one thing cut off from his message and his journey to Allah. It is a part of the bigger message that he's delivering. Like the Prophet ﷺ, when he saw that he's going to Mecca and making it a part of his journey with his companions. However, the vision of others like us, other than the prophets, is one part of 46 of prophethood, and the closer it to the truth, the higher it in ranking. And the higher it is in ranking, the most probable that our hearts are more suitable for receiving what we are receiving. So if you drive a car, for example, I don't drive cars, I don't know anything about cars, but I see different cars have got different mileages. Some cars can drive up to 240 miles per hour, but some car 160 maximum. So the one who's sitting in a car that can drive maximum 160 can never do 170. Can't. Doesn't work. According to the engine and the size of the engine and the speed of the engine. So the same thing. How spiritually strong you are. The more spiritually strong you are, That means your faith is strong. Hence, Rasulullah SAW says, to encourage us, المؤمن القوي خير وحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف. The strong believer is better and more beloved to Allah than the weak one. Not physically, but spiritually. And that's where we need to understand the differences. Okay? So if you are in a companionship of brothers or sisters, or studying together, or working together with a sheikh, whatever you are, in a club, wherever you are, and you are always close talking, and one person always see better than yourself, don't say why. No, it doesn't make sense. Why? Because he is spiritually stronger. Otherwise, when you say why, you are questioning him, why giving him more and not me? Or you are acting naive, not to understand that you are jealous. Because there's no other way. Either you are jealous or questioning Allah. Otherwise, you should not ask such a question. Because that means the answer is there. That means he is stronger than yourself. Imagine you two sitting here. One have got powerful internet, one have got very weak internet, and you are sending messages to the same place. The one who is powerful is receiving, and you are not receiving anything. You can't blame the companies. You blame how much you are paying for what you are getting. It depends upon how powerful the means that you have can allow you to achieve. Okay? And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Yusuf is going to explain to us the three different occasions in which vision have been seen, and all of them, not one of them, all of them came through. Whether it is for the ruler of Egypt, materially he's the highest, whether for the spiritual young man Yusuf, who saw his dream when he was, or his vision when he was young, and it is translated to be real while he is old in Egypt after the suffering he went through, and the prisoners with him. Number one, Yusuf said, Ya Abati, إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر رأيتهم لي ساجدين. سورة يوسف verse 4. Oh father, I have seen 11 planets and the sun and the moon. I have seen them, all of them prostrating before me. What does that mean? Doesn't mean anything to me. If I read it just like it is, how can the sun prostrate to you? How can the moon prostrate to you? These are the kind of vision that they need to be interpreted. And Allah is telling us this way because not all dreams come exactly. Sometimes they need to be interpreted, and that is very important to understand. This has come true. I don't want to go through the story of Yusuf, but you know that Yusuf alayhi salam was one of 12 children. He was number 11 in the line. His youngest brother called Benjamin, his oldest brother called Al-Bashir. And when they were all used to sit with their dad always asked them, have any one of you seen a vision? My dad used to do the same thing for all of us in the house. I ask my children all the time, because it's important. Vision govern our life. What did you see? It give us good tidings or it give us warnings? So everybody will explain. Yusuf, because he was the youngest or the second youngest, he was seeing the best of visions. And when he said this to his father, his father took him aside. He said, son, do not relate your vision in front of your brothers anymore. He now realized this is going to create a big test in the family. And there is going to be an upheaval. It made those older children become so angry with him. He had no fault. They start picking on him, start beating him up, giving him the hardest job to do, sending him away when there is something good to do. And everything that you can think of, as if he is not one of them. And they are the children of one of the greatest prophets, Sayyidina Ya'qub alayhi salam, Israel. And his children, the 12, Bani Israel. And then, subhanAllah, his grandfather is Sayyidina Ishaq. His great-grandfather is Sayyidina Ibrahim. Look, the children in this great noble family are plotting against their young brother. They throw him in the well for dead. He was found and sold as a slave. He was blamed falsely that he was trying to attack the queen, the wife of the Aziz. He was thrown into prison because he would not do what Allah has forbidden. As-sijnu ahabbu ilay. That prison is more beloved to me. The day he entered, two prisoners entered with him. From the day he entered the prison until he left it, he immediately began to do what he was taught praying his prayers, doing his dhikr, but not satisfied with himself unless he serve. Whom does he serve in prison? Anyone sick in the prison, he will go and look after them. Anybody in need of help, he will go and help them. Anybody in need of talking to, assisting, supporting. Those two prisoners who came with him, they were watching him. And they realized in him that many people don't see that this young man can't be in prison. We are criminals, as they say. He's not a criminal. He must be a good man. Later on, from their story, you will realize what they have seen in him. And then Yusuf, of course, came out. And then he became the treasurer in Egypt, a high job, responsible for all the money of Egypt. And his brothers came. And then he tested them and brought Benjamin to him. And then went and brought his father back to him. And then when they were all there, 11 brothers, 11 planets, والشمس والقمر, and my father, the sun, and my mother, the moon, were there, and they all, he brought them up where he's sitting, on his seat, brought them on the high platform. Before they hacked him or anything, they prostrated on the ground. Can you imagine that Sayyidina Yaqub himself making sujood to his son? Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Bid'a wa dalala wa shirk. How can he prostrate to his son? And he's a human being, flesh and blood. The one who doesn't understand will say this. But he did not prostrate. Just like Iblis, when he refused to prostrate to Adam. With Ghala Rabbuka al-Malaki, sujudu li Adam. Make sujood to Adam. They all made sujood, except Iblis. He stood there with arrogance. When Allah said to him, why? Lima? He said to Allah, asujudu lima khalaqta tina. Would you like me to prostrate to the one whom you created from the mud? Ah, you are better than the mud then. There are two questions here. You are better and you are not listening to me. I created you. You should be obedient to me. So he was not obedient to Allah. He disobedient. He became disobedient to Allah and he did not prostrate. Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam is a normal human being. But his father, his mother, his brothers prostrated for him not because of his beauty that is physical we can see. They prostrated to the beauty within, his noble character that will allow them to come and raise them, not to allow them to sit in the public, raise them to be with him. You understand it? Raise them to be with him. In the same level. And I will talk about this at the end to show you how noble he was. So his vision came true. The 11 stars he saw, his brothers, the sun and the moon, his mother and father. The Aziz of Egypt, the ruler of Egypt, says, وَقَالَ الْمَلَكُ, and the king says, إِنِّي أَرَى سَبْعَ بَقَرَاتٍ سِمَانٍ يَأْكُنَّ سَبْعٍ عِجَافٍ. I have seen in my vision fat 7 cows. Okay? And very weak 7 cows. إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ or إني أرى سبع بقرات سمان يأكلن سبع عجاف وسبع سنبلات خضر وأخرى يابسات. And I see also 7 ear corns that are green and full of corn, but 7 very dry, nothing in them. When he asks his people to interpret the dream, what did they say? He says, يا أيها الملأ, O people, أفتوني في رؤياي. Could you please interpret for me what I have seen? إِن كُنْتُمْ لِلرُّؤْيَا تَعْبُرُونَ. If you are aware of how to interpret visions. What did people say to him? His people said, قَالُوا أَضْغَاثُ أَحْلَامٍ. They said, they laughed. This is just from your imagination. This is your delusion. How can 7 cows and 7 weak cows and what is this? Doesn't make any sense. What happened is, Yusuf interpreted. And Yusuf's interpretation came only after the prisoners' dreams were interpreted. So we'll come to the prisoners first. Allah said in the Quran, وَدَخَلَ مَعَهُ السِّجْنِ فَتَيَانِ. And went into the prison with him 2 young men. قَالَ أَحَدُهُمَا, one of them says, إني أراني أحصر خمرا. O Yusuf, I have seen in my dream, I was making a drink. وقال الآخر, and the other one said, إني أحمل فوق رأسي خبزا تأكل الطير منه. I carry on my head bread and the bird were eating from it. نبئنا بتأويله إن أراك من أحسنين. Inform us with the interpretation of what we have seen. We see goodness in you. This, by the way, this is verse 36, this one. And the verse before it, 43 and 44. Subhanallah, how did they know he can interpret dream? I often ask myself, these are prisoners, they don't believe, but you don't have to believe to know what's true and what's not true. You don't have to believe to realize falsehood from righteousness. I was once in the airport in Heathrow, welcoming one sheikh, and he's a noble man, beautifully looking. And when you look at him, you remember Allah straight away. And there were a lot of people welcoming him. And while we were standing waiting, a lot of people were asking, what's happening? What's going on? Before he came out from the plane. And subhanAllah, wallahi, Allah is my witness. There is this Hindu woman. You could see from her dress and the way she is. She's not a Muslimah. And she was cleaning. She's one of those cleaning in the airport. All elderly woman. And once this noble sage came out, and people rushed to kiss his hand, the woman was pushing the people, went and kissed his hand. He didn't push her away. He allowed her. I didn't went to the sheikh, I went to her. I said, excuse me, why did you kiss his hand? I know she's not, I'm not gonna ask her, are you Muslim? None of my business. Maybe she's Muslim in her heart. And who am I to test her or to question her? But I'm asking about the action. A believer, you can ask about what's happening in the interaction. Why did you kiss his hand? She said to me, because he's a pious man. I wasn't satisfied. I said, how do you know he's pious? The way she looked at me, I could run away. She really gave me a look and said to me, and are you stupid? Are you? Can't you see? Does he look like any man of you? Does he look at anyone like you? This is a real man. So it tells me one thing. Allah is teaching me then, this lesson, not for anybody, for me, that it's not only you can see who's pious and who's not pious. Anybody can see. Man is being programmed from the beginning to know right from wrong. Not from me, from the Quran. Allah says, وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. You know the surah. You all memorize it to pray with it. وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. أَلَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ شَفَتَيْنِ. Didn't we give the human two lips? وَلِسَانًا وَشَفَتَيْنِ. وَلِسَانًا وَشَفَتَيْنِ. And a tongue and two lips. أَلَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ عَيْنَيْنِ. Didn't we give him two eyes? وَلِسَانًا وَشَفَتَيْنِ. And a tongue and two lips. وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. And we have programmed unto him right from wrong. Righteousness and falsehood. Clear, anybody could know. And that is something you could see even in your children. If you have a child, like your little girl, bath her, and suddenly there are people sitting in the next room and say to her, before you dress her, go and say salam. She'll say, Dad, are you crazy? I can't go naked, wouldn't she? Will she go naked? She will never go. Will you in the morning when you are going to work or college, university, go barefooted in the street? Leave alone, not dressed. You know what you will walk. If I said to you, walk, you don't need shoes, come on. It's summertime. I said, are you crazy? People will think I'm mad. It's the least you think of. We are programmed to know what's right or wrong. But yet our egos push us for the wrong because Iblis is working on that. Okay, so this is what happened there. So he interpreted the dreams for them. He said to the first one, and he used, by the way, to work in the palace with the king himself, the Aziz, as a deliverer for the drinks. He used to bring to the king his drink. These people are chosen especially because before the king drink, they have to take a sip from it. There is no poison, nothing, in the olden days. So they bring the cup, another cup, they pour a little bit from it and they will ask him to drink it. So he was a saqi. They call him saqi, the one who give the drink for the king. Yusuf said to him, you will be coming out of this prison after 3 days and you will go back and give your king the drink again. What happened? He was 3 days later, he was out and he was serving drink. Before he left, Yusuf said to him, when you are serving your king, please remind him of me. That there is a man in prison, falsely being accused, still in prison. No judgment has taken place. Either I'm guilty and be punished, or I'm free to go. That's what Yusuf wanted. And this is the lesson also for them. And the wisdom behind it is to remind him there is somebody who interpret the dream in the prison. He said to the second one, you are going to be crucified, and the bird will be flying, eating from the top of your head. And indeed, when that man was taken out, a few days later, this man was taken, crucified, and the bird were eating from his head. And that is a clear vision. Now, if any Muslim who think they know the truth, they say, well, these prisoners are kuffar, they're mushriks, they're mulhid, they're evil, they're hypocrites. How could they see visions? I will say to the person who says that, who are you to say they can see or not see? Are you Allah? Are you Ar-Rahman? Are you the sustainer? If a kafir can receive sustenance, eating, drinking, living, driving, some of the worst people ever living, like Fir'aun and Haman and Qarun, they were the richest men of this world. Even today, some of the terrible people, they have everything they want. Allah said, if it will not create fitna for people not to believe in me, I will make the kuffar have their homes built from silver and their roof from gold. But I promise you, for us weak Muslims, if this happening today, we say, we don't want Islam. We want these palaces. We want the gold and the silver. Even now, without that, sometimes we are escaping to that. You might say to me, how? Which has the most corrupt regimes in the world? Muslim countries. Which has the most corrupt civil services in the world? Muslim countries. Which has the most corrupt countries that pay bribe and take bribe? Muslim countries. Just 3-4 years ago, the Malaysian Prime Minister woke up in the morning in his account, there is less than $1 billion. When he was asked, I don't know where it came from. What do you want? You don't know? Suddenly, you wake up. Wow. Suddenly, you have over $900 million, man. Where did it come from? Out of 10 countries that are more corrupt, I think 7 or 8 are Muslim countries. Muslim people travel from here to Muslim countries where they should be trust and trustworthiness and goodness. And from the airport, you are asked for a bribe. I was in Nigeria traveling with some of my colleagues doing educational programs. And we came from one part of the internal airport to the international airport. And we're crossing the... We're already being checked everything. And we're just going through. And this policeman stops us. Excuse me, stops up, check, check. I said to him, what are you checking for? I want to see that you have got the right visa. I said to him, I don't need a visa. I'm just transit. I'm going by. And he looked and looked. My friend looking at me, he's a South African Asian. And he said to me, Sheikh, daddy, come on. Just let's go. We don't want to delay ourselves. I said to him, no. I want to see his end. So I said to him, what are you looking for? He said, I want to check whether you have a visa from this airport to that airport. I looked at him. I said to him, are you crazy? Are you mad? Where do you think I come from? You want a bribe? No. I said, no, you want a... Let's... People! I've started to act like it. People! This man wants a bribe because I don't have a visa from... And his other friends said, no, let him go, he's crazy. We shouldn't accept these things. Wallahi al-azim. Many of you sometimes travel, try to pass quickly, you pay a bribe. Don't. La'an Allahu rashi wal murtashi. La'an Allahu. Allah will curse the giver of the bribe and the receiver of it. You want to be like Iblis? I will never give a bribe. This is something that you need to think about and encourage yourself to keep away from this. But unfortunately, we think only this is happening in the poor, deprived, third world countries. Even in this modern, even our country here, take bribe. Once I was in Heathrow Airport, we're traveling British Airways when I was a student in the 70s, I think, late 70s, early 80s. And these people are carrying big bags and they are supposed to carry just 20, 25 kilos. And I think those two brothers put their weight on the scale and it was over 100 kilos. So the man said to them, tall Englishman, you need to pay the difference. And they couldn't. And they were, he said, look, separate it. They separated it. Still, they both have extras. So one of them realized he wanted to try anyway. So he put a 20 pound note was quite a lot of money, put it in the passport and gave it. He said to his brother, now take your thing out. I want to go for it. You check my first. I want to pay and go. The man, I could watch, he opened the night and the saw the 21, he dropped it. He put the passport aside, out of fear, out of, I don't know what's happening. He waited for him and let him go. He whispered to the rest, put a note in your passport. And I could hear everyone talking. So I said to my friend, what's he talking about? If you have extra luggage, put it on. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. And all they put money. Even some of them, they don't know even how much money they have. Everybody took £5, £10. And the man, I don't know how much money he got, but he didn't retain anything. He took everything. I was very sad. In a modern, civilized, as they say, democratic, with liberty and freedom and peace, somebody is taking bribes. So bribes, and by the way, when you talk about lobbying in parliament, this is not really lobbying, this is bribing. Yeah? Some MPs are chosen to be MPs by businessmen and supporting them to lobby for them. Even your Prime Minister, ex-Prime Minister Cameron, recently was questioned, yeah, you know, because he was lobbying for certain companies. What a nonsense. This is not really good for people. This is, you need to think about those things. So bribery is not. Let's come back to our subject, okay? Now, Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam then was brought to the king, because the man who gave the drink to the king, and he's still waiting for somebody to come and interpret his vision, and his people are telling him it's not a vision, it's a dream. In fact, a mishmash of many different dreams sewn in one thing, and it had no meaning. The man said, Ya Aziz, oh my king, in the prison there is someone who interpreted the dream for me, and it came through, and to my friend came, and he told him what the dream and the interpretation. He says, call him for me. So when they came to Yusuf, Yusuf said, I will come, but I want you to ask the Aziz, ما بال النسوة, why those women lied and put me in prison for something I didn't do? And that's a different story. And he was removed from the position he was in. So he came to the Aziz, stood before him, and he interpreted his dream like this. Okay? قال يوسف, يوسف عليه السلام. Now, the 7 fat cows and the 7 full green ear corns literally mean you are going to have 7 years of a lot of rain and a lot of produce in your farming. But it will be followed by 7 years whereby the 7 weak cows and the 7 dried ear corns, which are empty of any produce, are going to be dried years. 7 years that are going to really be terrible. So my advice is, from the first 7 years, save some of the grains that you are going to yield from your farms to the next 7 years. And guess what? Immediately, the Aziz or the king gave him the permission to become the treasurer of Egypt, because he will look after it, and he did. And this is where his brothers came back to him, and he looked after them, and then they became the way they were. Okay, now we come to what helps me and you to see a vision and to see it more regularly and to remember it. Because some of us think that a vision can only be seen sometimes. It's not true. Every time you are awake or asleep, there is a vision passing by. Can you see the jinn now? Can anybody see any jinn in this gathering? Can anybody see any malaika in this gathering? Although the Prophet said, when people come to remember Allah, there will be good jinn listening and there will be malaika surrounding you. This hadith of Rasulullah, and we believe in that. But we don't see it. Some can't see, some can't. The same way, there is like a film of visions going through. Some see it if it's supposed to help them, some don't see it. How can we maintain seeing? If we don't see while we're asleep, it's easy because we can't remember. When we wake up, we can't, alaykum as-salam abdul rahim, how are you, right? We can't remember. Okay, that is one thing. Sometimes, when we are awake, we can't see because we are not focused. Just like when you are turning a radio wave, unless you get it in the right position, there will be different sound mixed together, so you will not see. You will not hear anything. You will hear just different sounds. Until you put it in the right lens, then you can hear what you are supposed to hear. So here, I will say, we can derive from the lesson of seeing vision that every human being is being equipped to see while they're awake or asleep. However, what helps you to remember and what helps you to realize your visions is that which the Prophet taught us. The Prophet taught us a lot of things, but if you bring all his teaching and put it in one basket and get the two things or three things that will help you in this matter, being steadfast in your worship, what you have been commanded to do, avoid by all means anything that will disrupt the life of anybody else or make it terrible for them. That means backbiting, spreading rumors, being envious or being jealous, or just being wicked and rude and vulgar. That means your heart should be pure. The more pure your heart, the more you are able to sustain the visions and to remember them when you see them. Okay? Therefore, I say, مما يساعد سلامة الباطن, what will help you is to have a pure inner heart. وطيب النية, and a beautiful intention. ويقظة الضمير, and an awakened conscious. These are three things, but they are big things. In fact, we fasted Ramadan so we can achieve these things so that we can become. So number one, سلامة الباطن. You need to have your inner pure. From what? From envy, from jealousy, from anger, and from carrying any rancor against anyone or anything. It's tough. If you are in that position, I promise you, you will always be constant in seeing and constant in being reminded, because it's an inspiration. An inspiration for us comes in three ways. Come direct from Allah. Every one of us Allah speaks to. Some of us are able sometimes to grasp it. Some more often than others. Some never. And if we can't, Allah is so generous and just, the angel remind you. We call it Lammat al-Malak. Okay? The holding of the angel for you. To hold, say, look, remember Allah is telling you this. Wake up. Some of us have an indication to that, but some of us are not. And the third one, if this doesn't happen, then it is your inner beauty of your heart. However little of the goodness in it, it will help you. And therefore, Rasulullah said, استفتي قلبك وافتك الناس. Always tend to your heart, even if people give you the different interpretation of what you are looking for. Always go back to yourself. But many of us, the heart is blind. So we can't even consult our hearts. What next? The shayateen of the human and the jinn. If you don't really know where to go to seek the help and support, that is something you need to think about. Okay? So here, I will remind myself and you, comes a beautiful saying of the Prophet ﷺ, which he says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ما خاب من استخار وما ندم من استشار. The one who will make istikhara will never fail. ما خاب من استخار. The one who will make istikhara will never fail. وما ندم من استشار. And the one who will consult with the people of knowledge about the subject that they are going to embark upon, they will never regret. You are buying a car, consult people who know about cars. You are opening a shop, consult people who already have shops. You are trying to join a course, before you join it, consult people. But we don't do this today. And therefore we regret. If people join a course, 6 months later they, it's not for me, I'm going to... What a nonsense, wasting time. A believer doesn't waste time. A believer is always rushing to do things because time is important. Time is in the hand of Allah, and time is Allah himself, as he says, أنا الدهر والدهر بيدي. I am time and time is in my hand. Not literally meaning time is Allah. But what he meant is, I am working everything through time. And the time you are in, it's never going to come back again. You're not going to bring it back and change things. It's gone. Don't think of the past. And don't worry about the future. Worry about now. As long as you're alive and you are able to do. So istishara is important. So if you cannot grasp Allah's inspiration, and you cannot get the hold of the angel, and you cannot even consult your heart, don't be blind. Seek someone. Allah said in the Quran, Sayyidina Muhammad sallam, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُزَكِّيهِمْ وَطَهِرُهُمْ بِهَا. Take from their wealth a charity. You purify them and you cleanse them through it or by it. So therefore, you need to be charitable. This one of the means. So the Prophet was commanded to tell them in his time, so to purify their heart. Number two, if they come to you to consult you, O Muhammad Sallam, remind them before the consultation, they should give something in charity. So you see, some of the mashayikh, whether it is in Asia or Africa or sometimes in Europe, people come before their consultation. If you go for them to Mecca, the big mashayikh, when people come to consult them, they put envelopes. You think, what are they putting? They know the sheikh doesn't need this for the sheikh. This is for him to help those who are coming for help. Because a lot of people come and they ask for help. Some mashayikh, they receive it with one hand, they give it. I was sitting with a sheikh once, and somebody came from the Gulf and brought to the sheikh $3,000 in an envelope to help the school, the madrasa he's running. We all come and help before we talk to him and ask. And subhanAllah, a woman came and I was sitting there. The sheikh they always put it like this next to him. A woman came after the man left. The sheikh prayed for him. And the woman said, oh sheikh, I have a daughter. She's suddenly diagnosed with this illness. I can't find any place for her in the hospital here. They said the only cure for her is in the capital, Khartoum, which is far away. And I don't have the means and I don't have the money. It is a private hospital. SubhanAllah. The sheikh, without asking a question, took that envelope, gave it to her. Some of the people were sitting with the man and the man moved a little bit this way. They want to say to the sheikh, no, but this is, you know what is inside here? Because what she needs, maybe about $100 will help her. The sheikh gave her $3,000. I said to the brothers after the sheikh left and was sitting there, I said, brothers, I could see your eyes turning. You are worried about your big envelope. I don't know what is in it. And you are questioning yourself, that woman doesn't deserve it. Am I right or wrong? The brother said, oh, no, no. I said, no, no, no. The brothers were trying to push them. They were nudging one another. One of them said to me, but the brother brought this money, $3,000, to help in the madrasa of the Quran. I said, the sheikh knows, but this woman has need. This woman has need. He's not going to be, when you ask Allah, oh Allah, please help me. You don't state for him little or large. You just want the help. If the angel said to you, you are asking for a house, we are not going to give you even a room. How would you feel? If suddenly the angels came through with Allah's permission to give you £1,000,000, other angel comes and said, no, he doesn't deserve it. He's always doing the wrong. Just give him £100. How would you feel? Does it make sense? So here I'm telling you this because I want you, if you don't remember your dreams, don't think you are not dreaming. You are dreaming. Okay? Or you are having your visions. However, those visions, you are not realizing them because there is something holding you. What is holding you? That your inner is not being purified. Number one. How you purify your inner? By being charitable and by always consulting before you do anything. Follow the Prophet. And if you want, after the consultation, to make istikhara, make istikhara. And istikhara, by the way, they call it salatul istikhara. But you hear a lot of the modern brother, I don't know where they come from. They say, no, no, no. It's just a dua. Just read the dua. It's called salatul istikhara. Salah is not a dua in Arabic. When it's interpreted in English, they say salah is prayer and dua is prayer. I don't know what that means. Salah is salah. Salah is an emotional practice by bowing and prostrating and reciting whatever Allah is asking you to recite. But dua is supplication. When you are raising your hand towards the qibla of the heaven and asking Allah to forgive, to give, to close door of evil, to open door of khayr, whatever. So anybody who's saying to you, Salat al-Istikhara is just a dua, tell him, what does Salah mean? It means before you make your Istikhara and you read the dua of Istikhara, pray two raga'as. Al-Faris raga'a Fatiha and Kafirun, second raga'a Fatiha and Ikhlas. When you finish, make Istighfar, make Salawat, and then raise your hand, Allahumma inni astakhiruka bi'ilmika. Oh Allah, I am making Istikhara through your knowledge, for I have no knowledge. Wa astaqdiruka bi'qudratika. And I seek from your taqdeer, through your destiny to me, that which you know better than myself. I don't know anything. I'm asking for this thing, maybe it is bad for me. You said, sometimes things that I think are good for myself are bad for me. I'm leaving it to you to choose for me. You know the dua, all of you. Don't make anything until you make istikhara. And don't make istikhara until you make istishara. I keep repeating it, but people are not listening. You need to listen, because in this time especially, If you follow those simple things, your life will improve and you will get better, because it is a tough time for people generally. Okay? And the second thing is to have pure intention. Don't have bad intentions. Don't intend for anyone or anything that you do not intend for yourself. Once your inner side is carrying things against people and wanting ill for people, what kind of a human being are you? Even the worst human being. Hitler, according to history, was a very terrible man. But if he's living today with me here, I would love to meet him, to invite him to Allah. For every person who is distant from Allah is a potential Muslim. And my job and my role as a Muslim, where there is no messengers today, where there is no prophets, for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the seal of prophet and the final messenger, I am the messenger. You are the messengers. You are representing him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you don't follow him and you deliver the message in your own way, you are wrong. And if you don't deliver it at all, you are wrong. You might say to me, but I'm not trained. I'm not asking you to go out and give speeches and talks. I want your behavior to be inviting people. I want you to be truthful. I want you to be honest. I want you to be kind. I want you to be lenient. I want you to be good. I want you just to have a smile in your face, not frowning all the time. Please, this is the message for today. Be a Muslim. A Muslim, other people are saved from them, whether their tongue or their hands will never harm them in any way. And the final thing here in this matter, يَغْدَثُ الدَّمِيرُ. You have to have an awakened conscience. What does it mean to have an awakened conscience? You can't pass a street and see somebody saying, please, a cup of tea. And you think, he can go and sign and get his money from the Department of Social Security. Come on. He didn't ask this about it. You are not the Department of Social Security. He said, you, please help me. You raise your hand, oh Allah, please help me. And then you say, come on, I'm not helping you. Go and ask somebody else. I'm telling you, if this is translated with us and the Malaika, we will see how naive we are. Don't. Allah said, فَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ يَا أَخِي. Don't tell anybody who's asking. Either give them or leave them alone. Some brothers and sisters want to be very clear. Brother, how are you? How old are you? He's not applying for a job to ask for it. He's just asking for a cup of tea, asking for a meal to eat. He's hungry, he's tired, you could see him. Brother, are you working? What do you mean I'm working? Brother, do you need a job? I don't need a job, I just need a cup of tea. What kind of nonsense is that? And it hurt me when I see Muslims doing that. You know whom do I love when I see people helping poor people? English, middle class people, especially the young ones, going dressed beautifully, clean. They drive the most, they sit with them, they hold their hand, they give them a hug. And we think, oh, astaghfirullah, he's filthy, he's dead. What's this? The help we throw away to them. What kind of people? If you have that in your heart, wallahi, you will not be connected. Wallahi. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحب المساكين. He صلى الله عليه وسلم used to love those people. Sit with them, hold them, comfort them, eat with them, because you don't know who they are. Allah is with them. If you are really want to help yourself, help. If you don't like those, if you have got, how do you have a nafs when your ego is terrible? You don't have to be a tyrant, oppressing people. Your nafs is evil when you distance yourself from 30 people. You get to the bus or the train and you say, oh, no, I'm sitting next to them. Who are you? If you feel like that, something is wrong with you. Be very careful to judge people. Do you know maybe the person you are sitting next to is a very pious person? I can tell you hundreds of stories from my own life whereby Allah tested me and I knew nothing. But I learned thereafter the person I was just seeing is somebody special. Can I go back? It never happened. I tried. I looked. I regretted. Don't judge people. Be very careful. Either help or just mind your own business and go and do your things. What will stop you from not remembering, from not having a continuous way of link to realize your vision? Okay? By forgetting. So you might have the vision, you wake up, you realize you had the vision, but you can't remember it. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Just like you are going working and you took this big bunch of money, put it in your pocket, you came home and your family, alhamdulillah, we have income today. You put your hand in your pocket and there's nothing. I just saw a vision, but Sheikh, I can't remember it. Imam al-Ghazali says, for the person who forgets, there are things you do. He mentioned 17 things. I can't mention all of them. But he mentioned three of them that I always watch people like to do. Don't eat sour things. This is physical, but in spiritually it's... So if somebody spiritually is being pulled, if there is somebody who went into hell, if people don't know what hell is, if suddenly you started doing a lot of zikr, a lot of fasting and worship sometimes, an infisam will happen. Your nafs will behave in a way whereby people think you are crazy, but you are not crazy. You have reached a position whereby there is wonder in front of you, but you can't control yourself. You are behaving in a way where people know he's crazy, he's mad, but you are not crazy. How do we get the person out of this? If it happened immediately, we give you something sour to drink. It will bring you back. I remember once, these brothers were in the 80s. London was beautiful, da'wah was beautiful, a lot of mashayikh, a lot of zikr. These brothers went to their own home. One of them said, let us do zikr. And they started doing beautiful zikr, and they were following it properly. And one person went into hell. And he was crying and screaming, and it was night. 1 o'clock in the morning, I think, or 2 o'clock in the morning. It was terrible. So they rang me. And my wife woke me up, and I said, what's wrong? They said, oh, it's happening now. So I said to the brother, who is doing this? They told me that. I said, call him. I said, go to the fridge. If there is orange juice, pour a little bit in a glass, give it to this person. But Sheikh, I said, just give him the orange juice. And I put the telephone down. Next day, everyone was ringing me. How did you do that? I said, I didn't do anything. What did you give him? Give him orange juice. I became all right. I said, that's the idea. The nafs can easily be manipulated. Easily. Especially it is linked with the physical world. But if you cannot bring it up to link with the upper, to serve your soul, then you are in trouble. Okay? So you need to make sure that don't eat sour things so that you don't forget. If you are having a shower or a bath, or if you are in a countryside, there is a river running, don't pass water on those places. A lot of people do. Don't. Be very careful. One of the things that Imam al-Ghazali speaks about, you don't know what you are doing. Because if you can see what you are doing, you will not refrain, you will be running away from the place you are doing it. Be very careful. Yeah? So some people think it's not normal. It's just something that I cannot go further, but be careful. And number three, you need to make sure, and I can say this again and again, don't go to your bed and you are carrying any ill feeling against anybody. It's hard to say, it's difficult to achieve, but without it, it's tough for you. Be very careful. These are the three things, but there are other things he said, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. Okay? Second thing he said about why people do not remember their vision or realize them, اشتغال النفس ما لا يعنيها. When you are busy yourself with that, does not concern you. Some people are just all of them dropping their ears listening and passing the messages, reading in there. What is it to do with you? The Prophet ﷺ one day came out of his home, running to the masjid, went to the member and said, Tuba. Tuba is a special place in paradise to the one whom he is more busy with his own fault rather than looking at the fault of others. Tuba liman shagalahu aybahu an uyuban nas. So do not busy yourself with the fault of others, but keep yourself busy with your own faults. Whenever you see fault in others, to retrieve from the position of trying to criticize or say anything, imagine this is a mirror image of yourself. The Prophet ﷺ says, Al-mu'min mir'atu akhi, the believer is a mirror image of his brother or sister. So this is the second. And the final one, وَتَمَسُّكُهَا بِالْأَوْهَامِ. When your ego, when your nafs is holding on those thoughts, those imaginary falsehood that is happening to yourself, imagining, if this happened, if that happened. The Prophet said, if we'll open the works of shaitan, if is no good. If Allah wills, it will happen. If Allah doesn't will, it will never happen. That's it. It is in the hand of Allah and keep. We come to the last part. And here, for us today living in this world, imagine we wake up, whether we see regularly or sometimes, often or not, we see vision. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the messenger peace and says, إذا رأى أحدكم ما يحب فليحدث به. If one of you sees that which he likes in his vision, he can talk about it. وَإِذَا رَأَى مَا يَكْرَهُ فَلِيُحَوِّلْ إِلَّا جَنْبِهِ الْآخِرِ If you see in your vision something you don't like, if you are lying to your right, then turn a lie to your left. And turn to your left side, and spit three times. Yes. Without spitting, in fact. But with your mouth, go three times. أَعُوذِ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم three times and that will keep away whatever you have seen and the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith وليدفل عن يساره ثلاثا he should speak three times to his left وليستعذ بالله من شرها and seek refuge in Allah from the evil of what he has seen ولا يحدث بها أحدا and does not tell anybody about it فإنها لن تضره it will not harm you. What do we understand from this? We understand from this that when you receive ni'mah, bounties, goodness from Allah, you should keep it to yourself, fearing envy or jealousy. The Quran speak about it, and the Prophet said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Quran says, in the case of Yusuf, verse number 5 in Surah Yusuf, his father said to him, لا تقصص رؤياك على إخوتك. Do not relate your vision to your brothers. فَيَكِيدُ لَكَ كَيْدًا Then they will plot against you. His father knew. And Yaqub knew everything. But Yaqub was a part of the test himself to Yusuf and to his brothers. Because he's a messenger. Allah informed him already what's going to happen. Okay? But he was. Number two, the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, اِسْتَعِينُوا عَلَىٰ قَضَىٰ حُوَجْكُمْ بِالْكِتْمَانِ Help yourself in completing the best that you are doing for yourself or others by being silent. Conceal it to yourself. فَإِنَّ كُلَّ ذِي نِعْمَةٍ مَحْسُودٍ Indeed, everybody who receive a bounty, people will be jealous against them. People will be envious. You see? Sometimes some people who are jealous, they can't help themselves. They say it loudly. Look at him. Look at the car he's driving. Why are you saying such a thing? You are telling everyone I'm jealous. And if you say to the person, are you jealous? He said, no, I'm not jealous, but look at him. He is nothing and he's driving a car worth 100,000 pounds. You are jealous, 100% jealous. Otherwise, you not even mention it. Leave it, don't talk like that, because this is not good for you. And remember, Allah says, مِن شَرِّ حَاسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدْ Seek refuge from the envy when they envy. So if you are telling me that, I'll say, أَعُوذِ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ مِن شَرِّ حَاسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدْ You are a hasid. I seek refuge in Allah from you, okay? Now, I'm going to conclude by what Yusuf alayhi salam has taught us in the surah from the dreams. Yusuf taught us that life is not built upon falsehood. Life is built upon the truth. And the reason is Allah is the truth. And His words are the truth. And everybody who wants to be connected to the truth through the words that are revealed to be truth can never be connected without themselves being truthful and being honest. Hence your messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam from childhood, if he was known for anything, he was known always to be truthful and honest. As-sadiq al-ameen. You go to every masjid, in any place in this world, village or town or city, large or small, people with knowledge or without knowledge, describe the Prophet, as-sadiq al-ameen. In their na'at, in their poetry, even the modern English, I hear them making their poetry, whether it is rapping, whether it is modern kind of, whatever it is, everything truthful, honest. How can we connect to the truthful and honest, to be connected to the truth, Allah Almighty, subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we are not truthful, if we are not honest ourselves? That defeats the object, so be careful. This is number one. Okay, so Yusuf, we learn from him, because he was somebody from early age who was being very truthful and honest to the extent, if you look at it, as if he was naive the way he was relating himself to his brothers, and although his father knew what they are going to do with him. Okay? Yusuf reached his position because he was somebody who was always avoiding the haram. This is seen clearly when his brothers took him out and plotted against him and threw him in the well. He never carried anything in his heart. He never swore at them. He never called them name. He never said to them anything to make them feel wicked or evil. He realized this is his destiny. He was thankful to Allah. If this is the way I'm going to be, I thank you. They are sinners and I forgive them, ya Allah. And what did he do? He cried, he screamed, why is this happening to me? Why my old brothers have to do this to me? Or blame his father? He persevered with patience. And Allah says in the Quran, Allah is indeed with those who are patient. Allah is indeed will always be in the support of the patient. And Allah loves those who with patience. If you are patient, Allah loves you. And Allah is with you, and Allah will support you. Okay? Second thing, or the third thing, al-muthabara li'ibad al-khairat. To be rushing always to do good. Look at Yusuf. Yani, a free man, son of the greatest prophets, suddenly sold as a slave, put in prison. And he goes to the prison rather than sitting, being angry, trying to find himself ways to free himself and fight and make himself to be... No. I'm saying this because today some of us want to correct the state of the poor people in the world or the Muslims in Palestine. We go out in demonstration, we swear, we shout, we beat, we throw stones to the police. What is this? What is this, for goodness sake? You can't change wrong by wrong. That's why we are not getting anywhere. How many demonstrations I see going for Palestine? What did we do? Yes, some people go with good intention. But some, they go as if subhanAllah, they're planted as a test. I wish all the people who organize these things tell people, if you are going to do anything wrong, we are going to say loudly, he's not one of us. She is not one of us. Because, oh, I'm fighting, I want to get... You can't get anything. Throwing a stone at the police in London. What change is going to do to the Palestinian poor woman who just lost her child? In return, you are going to make the wicked among the people who are doing wicked things with the support of Iblis to say, look at these wicked people. They are burning our flag. They know how to manipulate you. Burning the Israeli flag is a good thing, it's a wicked thing, it's an evil thing. Imagine the Prophet's flag is being burned. A flag, by the way, is not a joke. A flag in Islam is so important. That's why you see all the schools of Islam, they have flags, they have banners. And every tariqah, Sufi tariqah, they have flags. Because the Prophet made it a sunnah to have a flag. His flag was Muhammad Rasulullah. Muhammad is indeed the messenger of Allah. This is his flag. To prove that I am the messenger of Allah. I worship only Allah. I turn to no one only Allah. And now I see some of the Muslims burning the American flag, walking over it. So imagine they bring our flag and walk over it. And they did. They took the flag of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which the stupid, those people who claim to follow his example in Daesh, whatever you call them, and they were walking over it and they were burning it, and some people burning the Quran. What's this? Who is bringing Islam to disrepute? Us, not them. For Allah says clearly in the Quran to those who have knowledge and those who understand and those who to be true to what they claim to be, do not insult the gods of those who worship beside Allah. For in ignorance they will turn and insult Allah. Do not burn the flag of those who are doing the wrong. In ignorance they will burn our flag. They will put us down. What benefit did we get? I haven't seen any benefit. Nothing. Only we look silly, we look stupid, we look... From the time when they burned the book of Salman Rushdie. What's this? I said to somebody, the most stupid thing to burn. And look what happened 2 years, 3 years ago in Tombuctu, when those brothers came in with their flag, they want Tawheed. They want the biggest manuscript library in the world. They tried to take the books, the manuscript, and to burn them. But thank God there are people who were good. They were stealing them and putting them, hiding them somewhere else. They managed to burn about 5,000. Alhamdulillah, there are over 1 million manuscripts. No place in the world, no religion in the world, no community in the world has many manuscripts written about their faith, their history, their culture than the Muslims in Tombuctu. If you didn't visit it and go and say, I have seen it. This is a place to visit, not to go on to the seaside and have suntan. What nonsense, what rubbish. Siyaha in Islam is to go and visit the places where you can learn history and gain knowledge and understand and be a human being, not be an animal and do the wrong thing that is not. People go to the seaside, they become animals, running after the flesh. What is this? And you hear people going to Spain, They go and they come back, they're drunk. What benefit? Some of them, they wake up in the morning, they're naked. I don't know what happened to me. What is this? Wallahi al-Azim. Please learn something. Help. Support. You are here. If you hear this from your colleague that work, from your friend, your neighbors, try to educate them by you not indulging with them or sympathizing with them, by standing like Yusuf. Be above those things that the ego will call for. Okay? Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam also strive to always leave anything that is munkar. Munkar meaning people do not approve of. Anything people do not approve of, move away from. And he was always in love with the miskeen, the deprived and the poor. Allah says in the Quran, وَكَذَلِكَ يَتَّبُوكَ رَبُّكَ وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْحَدِيثِ. For this reason, O Yusuf, Allah has brought you nearest to him. And Allah has perfected you for himself, and he has taught you the interpretation of the visions or dreams. That means this knowledge is there, but Allah teaches it. There is no, you don't go to college or university to be taught knowledge. But today, mashallah, in your modern world, you can go to your Google and you can get interpretation of your dream. Mashallah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Astaghfirullah. I'm sorry, but it doesn't make sense. If Allah says we are teaching the meaning, who is writing this? This becomes like clairvoyancy. When you open the Sun or the newspapers, whatever, and you find people at the end writing your stars. You know, in London, there used to be a newspaper called Al Arab. And a friend of mine, Libyan, he used to be one of the very special friends of mine. Very good, he's always asking questions. One day he was saying to me, Sheikh, since I came to study with you, because he likes spirituality, I learned I am false. I said, what do you mean you are false? He said, you know Al Arab? I said, yes. The newspaper, I said, yes. He said, there is a man who writes the stars in it. I said, I have never seen it. Then he opened a newspaper, showed me. And the stars write, today, your day, you'll have this, you'll have that. He said, you know what is written here? Yeah, I write them. I said, but the man said he wrote them. He said, no. He comes to me because he doesn't know anything. And he knows I'm spiritual. But I make them up. I said, are you sure? He said, by Allah, Sheikh. And I'm trying to confess in front of you. I write them. People believe in them. And they don't know I'm writing them. He just make them up. Anything come to his head. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. This is why Rasulullah says, even if the clairvoyant tell you the truth or a part of the truth of what is being related to you, don't believe in them. They're lying. كذب المنجمون ولو صدقوا. The clairvoyants are liars even if they tell you a part of the truth or the truth. They will never tell you because they don't know the truth. They just make it up. You see, and anybody can do that. Okay? Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam was chosen by Allah, brought nearest to him. Allah taught him how to interpret the dream, and for this reason, he managed to interpret the dreams of the two prisoners. They managed to see in him the signs of the good doers. They managed to see on him truthfulness, trustworthiness, and that he always loves to do khair or goodness to anybody he knows or he doesn't know. He doesn't carry anything in his heart against anybody. Remember Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, he did not really blame the wife of the Aziz of Egypt. When they free him, he didn't say to her, you wicked woman, la la la. It's why she became a believer. That's why she trusted in him. She freed herself. Imagine, Allahu Akbar. This is really, really something to think about. That this woman who was running after him, she said, I put my hand up. I am the one who was wrong. I don't want him to be believing that I cheated him of his right. She regretted what she did. And Allah accept the regret of the people who regret genuinely. Okay? And then Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam was wronged by his brothers. There is fire. And his brothers threw him in the well and he was sold as a slave. But subhanAllah, look, they came to him and nothing happened. When they came to him before the prostration took place, they were worried. And they're frightened, what will happen? What will he do? You know, usually people want to take revenge. Leaders will put people in prison, torture them. Whether you are civilized or not, America is a civilized country. They took people to Guantanamo and torture them. They can say anything they want to say. Even if they are wrong, you don't do that to human beings. That's wrong. And they say, no, we don't do that. You do it. Whether you are people of liberty or not, maybe they are wrong. How can you take a child and put him in a prison away from his family? What is this? A child? What kind of humanity is that? These are the things that we need to talk about. When you see the wrong, say, this is wrong. not burning a flag or doing something silly which doesn't mean anything but bring you disrepute. When his brothers came to him and he's in a position of power, Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam in Surah Yusuf, verse 92, he says to his brothers, when they ask him, what are you going to do with us? قَالَ لَا تَثْرِيبَ عَلَيْكُمْ. You fault me not. You are blameless. اليوم يغفر الله لكم. Today Allah will forgive you. وهو أرحم الراحمين. For it is He the most compassionate, most merciful. What does this mean? He means, I carry no blame in my heart since you put me in the position I was in. And I will carry nothing in my heart until I die. But I forgave. I wiped away from my heart any residue of anything to make me angry with you. And today, I make my relationship with you better than before. And I will prove it by asking Allah to forgive you. Because what is between you and people will never be forgiven until the people forgive you. Allah can forgive you what is between Him and you. But what is between you and people, you have to go to them. That's why people, they rush before Hajj, please forgive me. Why do you go in Hajj? You wait until you are going to Hajj, you go and ask people to forgive you? Isn't it foolish? Every time you have a mistake with somebody, ask them for forgiveness. Ask them to forgive you and pray for them and forgive them. Therefore, finishing this subject, my brothers and sisters, a vision is important in the life of the human being generally. A vision is absolutely paramount in the life of the Muslim believer who trusts that Allah is guiding him to himself. And Allah can guide him through inspiration that he might receive or not. But one of the ways of being inspired is to see a vision. It is a way for guidance. And therefore, we need to take absolute understanding of where we are and where we are going through dreams. And finally, what will help me and you to remember our dreams or our visions that we see? There are many things, but there are four things that I will mention. There is a verse in Surah Yusuf, verse 100, a part of it, the last part. إن ربي لطيف لما يشاء إنه هو العليم الحكيم. إن ربي لطيف لما يشاء. My Lord is latif, is gentle to whatever He wishes, for it is He the most knowledgeable, the most wise. If you read this regularly, every day, perhaps before you go to bed 33 times, or if you want to read it because of the name Latif. Latif is very useful for removing veils. Therefore, it is one of the most powerful names to recite for purifying one's heart. But it requires guidance. So you don't do it just by yourself. You can do the Prophet numbers. The Prophet numbers that he has given is up to 100. Anything you find in the books written, recite this 7 times, 3 times, 40 times, 70 times, 100 times, the Prophet has said this. If you find more than this, then the person whom you are taking it from, ask for permission. Because people say, why do I need permission? Because it didn't come directly from the Prophet to you. Anything the Prophet says is for every Muslim. But anything else coming from somebody else, Abdul Ghadir Jailani, Ahmed al-Badawi, Ahmed al-Rifai, Ahmed al-Sughi, whoever it is, you say to them, have you got a chain? Through your chain, you can take it. So I have a chain in Latif, and Latif, you read it 129 times. So if you really want to benefit from this name, after every salah without fail, and for women, when they are not praying, at the time of the salah comes, you remember it and make zikr as well. 129, ya latif, 9 times, then 20 times, then 100 times. You can do it with your hand. 3 fingers, each one have got 3 parts, 9 times. Then 15 for the 5 fingers, and then you do 5, 3, 18, and 2, 20 times. So you do 9, then you do 20, and then you do 100. 100, you do 6 times, all your hand, and then you do 10. Easy. And in fact, it's faster to do zikr with your hand. Yani I can do 1,000 with my finger more than I can do it with my beads. Yani with my beads, it takes me longer. I can do a name with my beads, let's say 1,000 times, 5 minutes, but I can do it 2 minutes in my hand. Because Allah is so powerful in telling you how to do things, but we don't understand His power through realizing what we are going to get through His teaching. So we don't get there. So, Ya Latif, after every salah, 129 is good for purifying your heart. If you can, do it. You have permission. Reading this verse, 33 times every time before you sleep, if you can. It does not take you a long time. And if you want to do it 129 times, it's also good. By the name of Latif. The second one, a verse in Surah Al-Mulk, 14 times. Sorry, Surah Al-Mulk, verse number 14. Okay? أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Wouldn't he know? And it is he, the gentle, the one who is aware of everything. You can recite this verse 27 times, or you can recite it by the name Khabir 129. Also, you have permission to read that. By the way, 33 for the first verse is the number of the letters in the verse. And 27 is the number of the letters in the second verse. That's why you might ask why 27 to 33. Number three, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said to the Prophet sallam, how can I make sure the vision I see is good? And how can I remember my vision regularly? He said to her, oh Aisha, before you go to bed, recite this dua. Allahumma arini ru'yatan tayyibatan saliha wa dhakirniha wa la tunsiniha. Allahumma arini ru'yatan tayyibatan saliha wa dhakirniha wa la tunsiniha. Oh Allah, show me a vision that is good and that is righteous, and make me remember it, and don't allow me to forget it. Very beautiful. And every night you should read this as well, more than other thing you read. And finally, according to some of the scholars, it will also help the believer if you go to your bed with wudu, and if you sleep on your right side, even for a few seconds while you are reading your du'as, and continuously read dhikr until you sleep. Okay, any dhikr, la ilaha illallah, salawat for the Prophet sallam, or bismillahir rahmanir rahim, which is very good to repeat before you go to bed, and inshallah, it'll be good. Somebody might ask a question, what about those people who are not Muslim and they see visions? That is Allah's choice for them. Allah chose for them to see, and they will see. But you as a Muslim, you want not just to see, you want your seeing to be in a specific, proper place for your guidance and perseverance in the path you are in, inshallah. And here I finish. And I'm going to let you, if you have any question about this subject, please, we'll answer it. And if it's about this subject, we can leave it to another time, because I don't want to waste your time. And anybody with a question about visions? You are a satisfied lot. Alhamdulillah. Yes, my sister. Wa alaikum as-salam, my sister. I can't hear you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man ra'ani faqad ra'ani, inna ash-shaytana la yatamathalu bi." Whosoever seen me in a vision, he had definitely seen me, for shaitan will never come to be me. From this, we realize that shaitan sometimes take the form of others other than Rasulullah sallam. So you can see Allah in a vision, but you don't see Allah as a body, but you will realize Allah in a vision. You could see angels in a vision. You could see jinn in a vision. You could see other creation that we don't know of in a vision. You could see the past, the present, the future in a vision. You could see whatever, anything you could see. The only way you realize what you have seen is good or bad is by the way you relate it to somebody who knows and they interpret it for you. But if you see something that is worrying to you or frightening to you or not really fitting within your heart, the Prophet said, if you are lying to your right, turn to your left, and then on the side of the left, okay, you spit three times, the Sa'ud ibn Ashtar Rajim. And if you are right to your left, turn to your right, and then go to the left and speak three times and do the same thing. But visions should not be related to anybody. When you see a vision that is good about somebody, yes, you can inform them about it. If it needs interpretation, seek interpretation before you relate it to them, so that they get confused. There are some people who will go to people and say, by the way, I saw you in a vision last night. Yeah, Wallah, I saw something bad. I don't know whether to tell you or not. Why are you telling me then? The Prophet said, don't tell bad vision to people. Even about yourself, don't talk about it. Keep away from relating bad vision. If you see a saint in the dream, usually it is a good dream. If you see a prophet in a dream, good. If you see a surah of the Quran, everything had an interpretation. Everything. But it needs to be related to the one who knows how to interpret it. Okay? Now. Alaykum as-salam. Whom do we seek to interpret dreams or our visions? We need to look at somebody whom fits the description of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam. And there are four or five things usually in a person you can seek. First of all, the person should have the knowledge of the deen. Okay? It could be a scholar, it could be a sheikh, it could be an imam, it could be just a wise person in the community. But then, they must be truthful, and known to be truthful, they must be honest. They must be kind, gentle, merciful. You don't see anything wicked from them. They must be always see them rushing to do good and help others other than themselves. And you must see them humble within the community. And for example, when I was young, like you, I used to think, whom I can go to? So sometimes I go to certain imams or mashayikh, people know them. But if I see any of those things not in them, I go straight away. And I remember once upon a time, they sent me to this man and they said, oh, he's fantastic, go to him. Because I'm always asking questions. I went and sat in his majlis, and suddenly he said a rude word. To me, that is enough. I don't want to know. Not even one rude word that does not fit with me. I want to tell everything. I said, I didn't tell him. I said, no, it's not for me. I have the choice. I'm not, my soul is not to be conquered by anybody. Or you can enslave my body. You can beat me up. You can imprison me. You can torture me. But you can't take my soul. I will not sell my soul to the devil. You sell your soul to the devil when you accept to follow anything like a sheep. No. You see, you have to be careful. This is your akhirah. Your soul is for the akhirah, not for the dunya. Your nafs is for the dunya. Yeah. Yes, my brother. Alaykum as-salam, Sidi. How are you?
Alhamdulillah. Thank you. Ibn Sirin.
Yeah.
Dream interpretations. Is that a good guide to go to?
Yeah, it is not. But this is, you see, you are restricting it then. Dreaming is or vision interpretation is like fatwa. So I'm living in London now. If I ring a village in Sudan where there's a very good mufti, and he knows his religion very well, can I take a fatwa from him? Maybe I can, maybe I cannot, but for me I can't. Why? Because a part of what I know, the person who's giving me the fatwa should know the environment where I live and the circumstances I'm going through. Does he know that? I doesn't know that. How can I interpret him what I'm going through? I'm sitting in Rumi's, there are a lot of women sitting with me and men. He doesn't have these kind of, he doesn't know what we are going through. So it is wrong. For you, your future is your homegrown imam, the mashayikh in this land here, should be your muftis. If it is this way, one day Britain will have one house of ifta. Why there is one mufti in Pakistan? Every mufti goes to. Why there is one mufti in Sudan or Saudi Arabia? Because they have the same culture. But here we have got fragmented cultures. Bangladeshi, Pakistani, Sudani, Egyptian, whatever. This doesn't make sense. We're Muslims. And our culture is British culture, not Pakistani or Sudanese. Don't be judged. So the culture is very important. A fatwa, a part of it is the culture we live in. I'll give you one thing. Everybody is going and saying, mortgage is haram. Is really mortgage haram? Why mortgage is haram? Who says so? The mufti from Pakistan, the mufti from Sudan and Egypt, they say that. Yeah, but because they don't know how you are living here. There were no one, the most Muslim living in council homes and their children taking drugs and selling drugs, they're in prisons. This is nonsense. I'm not saying all council homes are bad, but most of them, you go to the lift, there is urine, there is condom, there is, what's this? How can I raise my children there? I'm trusted with those kids. I was offered, I said, no, I don't want. I will work 7 days, I will work 70 hours a week to live a life, even have one room, I don't care, to raise my children. So the ifta was made in Europe. I was one of the people who raised this issue. There used to be a council for muftis for Europe. Nowadays, everything is fragmented, but in the early days when I lived here, so the Council Muslim of Europe met the scholars from these countries, and they made the fatwa. And it went to Sheikh Al-Azhar at that time, and Sheikh Al-Azhar approved them, because there is a school of ifta called the fatwa for the person who is living in a land which is not Muslim land. Imam Malik used to tell his people, when you go, your fatwa shouldn't be like Medina. That's why I look at Imam Shafi'i, his student, went to Egypt, he changed a lot of fatwas to suit Egypt. So here, they made the fatwa. Why the person have to go and borrow to buy a home? And what liabilities will he hold? And what's the agreement? The agreement, when it was explained to them, is like renting. I'm borrowing money, and I'm paying monthly to these people. There is something, if you go to the Islamic bank in London, who are giving you mortgage, exactly the same, but more stringent. You are in banking, you know these things. I went, my wife said to me, no. I know the fatwa you brought is fine. Shall we go and buy through, let's go. I said, I took her to the best Islamic person who run one of these mortgages. It was in Baker Street. My wife sat next to me. I said to him, look, listen, I want to know everything about this halal mortgage. He said, Sheikh, ya salam, thank you for bringing your wife. I will help you, everything. And my wife began to ask him. I want her to ask. So she asked all the good questions. Then she said to him, how do you come to the rent you charge me? He looked around. He said to her, look, we are obliged to be linked to the Bank of England. Are you telling me somehow you are linked to the interest rate? He said, yes. Tell me. He said, no, I need to call. He called an Englishman from inside. This beautiful facade outside, Islam and Muslim, he couldn't do anything. The Englishman came from inside, sat down, explained to my wife. My wife said to me, shall we go now? I said, alhamdulillah. And we went with blessing. I got my first mortgage and I bought my place and I lived. I was paying rent, £400 a month, which was a lot of money in the early 80s. And my salary altogether would not reach £800. By the time I paid the council tax, and it was too much at that time, Mrs. Thatcher brought in, and paying my electricity, gas, this and that, all those things, I had little to live on. So I used to work 7 days, finish my work, and then go and do other works. I rarely see my children. Awesome. When I got the mortgage, instead of paying £400, I was paying £250. And in 25 years, if I can pay all the money to them, it's my place. Alhamdulillah, I thank Allah it is that. And I still pray for the Mufti who gave me that fatwa. Rahmatullah, Sheikh Darsh. He died, he was in London here. He was really fighting for us. He was saying to me, because I was young, he was an older man. He said to me, you are going to be living in this country, you need to know that you need to live. I don't want to see all the Muslims living under rent. And if suddenly the landlord, when they want to check them out, they can check them all out in the street. Not a viable thing for Muslims. The owner of the land is the owner, not the one who is receiving an income. Once you lose your job, you are in the street. So that is where I come from when it comes to this matter. So we need to be careful. So fatwa is like a dream. Don't ask anybody to interpret your dream to you unless you know that those people can help you with the interpretation in the right way. Did that answer your question? Alhamdulillah. Anybody else? Yes, it's Mahdi.
Two things. One, you know, like the Latif count, you give us the answer to do multiples of 129 as well.
Yeah.
Up until, like. And the second thing is, can you give us a formula to see the vision of our beloved?
I have learned in my lifetime a lot of ways to see the Prophet ﷺ. But the best one I have done myself, I took it from a sheikh. He said it in front of a lot of students. And I went and did it. And in the night I did it, I saw him ﷺ. And that was very simple, very easy. Every Thursday, after you pray your Isha, and you sit down, you have nothing to do, you read your Quran, your word, whatever you read every night. And by the way, consistency in reading what you read every day is more important than anything else. And the prayer you pray, the fard prayer, whether you pray it or not, you are responsible. Because if you pray it, you'll be rewarded. If you don't, you'll be punished. But it's the key for the zikr after. People do the prayer, and they think, oh, the zikr is not important. The azkar and the awrad you read afterward is more important. Okay? And therefore, if you recite on Thursday night, after you read everything you read every night, every Thursday night, As-salli Ibrahimiyya. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad kama salli ta'ala. As you read in the salah, 100 times. And ask Allah after you finish to remove the veils and to gift you. To gift you. From his presence, a gift of seeing his face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you don't see it in the first Thursday, the Sheikh at that time told the brothers, do it up to 7 Thursdays. But for me, if I see it, whether the first Thursday or second Thursday, I should continuously do it then. That means it's a good thing to do. So I went, all the brothers went. When we came the next day to the Sheikh, said, ha, anybody have seen? And I put my hand up, I said, yes, I have seen. He said, kafa, enough, let's keep it to yourself. So, it depends upon it. This is one way. There are other ways. But I think if a person keep one way and try it all the time, and rather than digging many holes and then you tear yourself and then you get nothing. But if you keep one constant one, every Thursday night without fail, read the Salah Ibrahimiyya 100 times and ask Allah to show you the faith of Rasulullah. For if you see him, you are lucky, inshallah. And you can see him, inshallah. I said it once to a student of mine in a big Arabic school in 1992 or 93, I can't remember. Yeah, is it? No. Wallahi, where is it? No, 88, I think, 88 or 87. And I said to the class, talking about Rasulullah, and one girl put her hand up. They're all about 13, 14 years old. You always talk about the Prophet Sallam, and you say people can see him. How can we see him? Just like you. So I gave them this, and it was Thursday, subhanAllah. Next day when we came, this girl, she's very skinny and very tall. She's only 13 or 14 years old, but she looks like she's about 16, 17 years old. You could see her from far away because she's tall. And she's never smiling. She's always frowning. And I always joke with her, I said, if you can only smile. Her name is Sakina. And subhanAllah, that day she was smiling. And I could see her smiling. So I went and before the assembly, everybody was coming. I said, Sakina, what's wrong with you? You're smiling today. He said, Sheikh, I have seen him. And imagine how happy I was. How it was really nice. Then we come to class and she said to the student, and everybody, why can't I see her? I said, look, if you didn't study, would you get an A star or an A? She said, no. I said, okay. She studied. She's always doing the right thing. She does what she's told. She's very consistent in her. Anybody else? Otherwise, make a dua, let you leave. May Allah bless you, guard you, strengthen you. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء وهو السميع العليم. بسم الله مجريها ومرساها إن ربي لغفور رحيم. بسم الله وبالله ومن الله وعلى الله وفي الله ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا أرحم الراحمين يا حي يا قيوم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام صلي وسلم على محمد العدنان وآله وسلم يا الله. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all our sins, to erase all our ill deeds, to purify our hearts, to make us among those people whom He loves, to look at us with His eye of mercy, to find us where He would love us to be, and never find us in places He has forbidden or disliked to see us in them, ya Rabbil Alameen. We ask Allah to purify our tongues from all that which is evil, to purify our eyes from looking at that which He has forbidden, to purify our limbs from doing that which He dislikes or He has forbidden, ya Kareem. We ask Allah to remove any rancor from our hearts, any ill deeds that are making us stay behind and not to be with those people who have reached the position that they have reached. Oh Allah, remove that, ya Kareem. Oh Allah, give us tawfiq to be among those people who will strive to always do good. Oh Allah, give us tawfiq to strive to keep away from ill deeds and bad deeds and evil acts that people carry out in the life, ya Kareem. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all those who are striving to find a way to link with Rasulullah, may Allah open their hearts, remove their veils, connect them with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah, make them steadfast in their 5 regular daily prayers. Oh Allah, remind them there is nothing that can connect them better than their 5 daily prayers, ya Kareem. Oh Allah, instill in them the establishment of Salah rather than doing Salah, ya Kareem. Oh Allah, instill in them your remembrance and keep them well and strengthen their faith and give them imanan qawiyan mani'an, ya Kareem, bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our parents who passed away, our uncles and aunties, grandparents, relatives, siblings, partners in marriage who passed away. May Allah forgive them and raise them to the highest of in Jannah. Those who are alive, may they have a long life with obedience, ya Kareem. I ask Allah, if there is anybody that we have wronged, may Allah forgive us. May Allah give them tawfiq to forgive us. May Allah repay them handsomely from ourselves. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all those who wronged us, whether we know them or not. Oh Allah, be a witness. Anybody that has wronged me, oh Allah, I forgive. Oh Allah, anybody who wronged me, you are my witness in front of those people, I forgive. And all those people who are sitting before me, I ask you to make it easier for them to forgive those who have wronged them, ya Kareem. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove all the veils to allow us to see the face of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this world, before the hereafter, in our awake state or in our sleep, ya Kareem. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all those who strived and worked hard during this pandemic to serve us, among the doctors and the nurses and the porters, the cleaners, the hospital managers, and all the staff who work in hospices, hospitals, old people homes, and all those who work in the front line, driving the fire brigade and the ambulances and doing all that which is difficult in shopping and shopping for elderly and stacking the shelves in the shops and doing the job that nobody will do. but they are striving to do to keep us living, Ya Allah. May Allah help them all. Those who passed away from them, may you forgive them. Oh Allah, they have served us, and we ask of you out of mercy to serve them. And those who are alive, guide them. And those who are guided, strengthen their faith and allow them to live a life of dignity and honor, Ya Kareem. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the students who are striving that they will succeed in their exams. And their vision will be pure and clear to do that which will please you. And those who are working, may they be steadfast in their work, honest and truthful, and allow them to earn their living from halal. Oh Allah, remove them from the path of cheating and lying and deceiving. Put them in the light of the Prophet Sallam, the truth, Ya Kareem. Oh Allah, I ask you for anybody who's sitting with me in front of me here with difficulty in their life, may you remove it. And anything they are asking for, as long as it will please you and it will be good for them, may you fulfill it. And anything that will remove an object of evil from their path, may you remove it, Ya Kareem. Oh Allah, I ask you for Rumi's cave staff and all those who are working, our brothers in the cafeteria, our sisters and brothers who are volunteering, may you help them, may you support them, may you guide them, may you strengthen them, may you give them tawfiq for dunya wal akhirah. And all the little children, all of them, Ya Allah, guide them, strengthen them, give them tawfiq for dunya wal akhirah. And we ask Allah to remove the pandemic and to bring us back to be in a better position, Ya Kareem. And oh Allah, we are here in this place, Carlton Center, which is Rumi's cave. By your permission, Ya Allah, you gave us this place. We have been in it for over 3 years now, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, it is in your hand to allow us to stay longer or to be removed from it. We wish and we hope through your mercy, by your mercy, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we seek refuge in you and we ask you to allow us to stay in this place, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, make Rumi's cave remain in this center without any removal from it ever, Ya Kareem. Oh Allah, the leaders of the council, Sayyid Muhammad Bat, Ya Kareem, and all his officers and his counselors will agree to allow us to stay in this place by your permission. إنك على ما تشاء قدير وبالإجابة جدير فإنك أنت الحي القيوم العلي العظيم تقبل منا وتب علينا وتولنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد وآله وسلم الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا نبي الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله ألف صلاة وألف سلام عليك وعلى لبيتك أجمعين سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين We ask Allah for the أولياء the sages the guardians of the lower world, those who are doing the beautiful job on our behalf, for they have chosen to strive and struggle and leave the pleasure of the dunya for the sake of the akhirah, leave the desires of themselves for the desires of those who are seeking to be close to Allah. Wherever they are, wherever they might be, all the awliya, al-akhtab, al-awtad, al-afrad, al-budala, al-nujaba, al-nuqaba, al-malamatiya, رجال الغيب اجمع ربي اسمه خاصة صاحب الزمان المهدي المنتظر عليه السلام والخضر عليه السلام ويس الغرني عليه السلام أبو بكر الصديق عمر الفاروق عثمان بن عفان علي بن أبي طالب والعشر المبشرين بالجنة وأزواج النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم خاصة خديجة الكبرى عائشة حفصة رب العالمين أولاده الطيب والقاسم وإبراهيم وزينب ورقي وأم كلثوم وفاطمة الزهراء والحسن والحسين وسائر الشهداء خاصة شهداء بدر وحد الخندق والأحزاب يا ربي بهم جميعا نتوسل اليك ونسألك في هذه الساعة إلا ما غفرت لهم ورحمتهم عبد الغادر الجيلاني، أحمد البدوي، أحمد الرفاعي، مراد السوق، أحسن الشاذلي وكل ولي سيدي السمان، شيخ الطيب ود البشير، قرشي ود الزين، شيخ عبد المحشي أقرب الله، سيدي وأستاذي ووالدي حفة أقرب الله ورحمة الله، سيدنا الشيخ حسن يا كريم، شيخ محمد برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين، وسائر الأولياء والصالحين خاصة الشيخ الصالح الجعفري، شيخ أحمد حمادة، شيخ الخطيب والشيخ الكردي، شيخ عبد السجاني، عبد الغني صالح الجعفري يا كريم. أبو يزيد البسطامي محدين العربي الإمام الغزالي حسن الجبائي وحاتم الطائي إبراهيم بن أتم سفيان الثوري ذنون المصري رابع العدوية عمر بن الفارد يا كريم جلال الدين الرومي We ask Allah for جلال الدين الرومي that Allah in this moment of time we raise him to the highest of this place in Jannah and we intercede to Allah through him that Rumi's cave will always be here to serve as he has been given the permission to serve to salvage people from their desires to Allah's desires يا كريم وإلى سائر الأولياء والصالحين وكل من حضرنا في هذا المكان ملك الموت وجل وعلا الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين جزاكم الله خيرا May Allah bless you. Two announcements to make. The first announcement is about this cafeteria. We tried, inshallah, in this time to have a cafeteria that will be serving meals every day. But not any meal, proper professional meal. Alhamdulillah, we have a brother. May Allah bless him. A Malaysian businessman who came and helped in this. May Allah help him dunya wa akhirah. And his wife as well. May Allah keep them safe and look after them. And his daughter. And so he brought this company and they started a professional, proper job. We would like you to spread the word around. Because really for Muslims, there is no place to go and eat properly. This is a place they can come, they can ring, they can. There is no booking, they can come anytime. It's open. And Alhamdulillah, government had no restriction in the seating for eating within inside the building. But in the summer now, we will have outside. And they have got different look into them, ask them questions, support them and help them. For in their support, they are supporting the poor and the needy. And they are taking the place so that whatever they make, 50% of it will go to help the poor among the homeless people and what they do in Rumi's cave. And may Allah help them. May Allah give them tawfiq and success. They will not just serve you here. They also do yani, anything you want. You want a birthday party. You want an engagement party. You want just a friend party, a celebration of graduation, whatever it is. You can come and do it here. At least you have a place to pray. What else? I said, maybe you give me extra things that they do. Okay? Whatever they do, yani you can come here and inshallah they will do it for you. Or also they can deliver the food for you at home. Take their telephone number and you can think. The nearest place to go and have Malaysian food, and they're very good food. If you haven't eaten Malaysian, very, very good food. And Malaysian people, by generally, they're the best people. I think they represent Islam because they have got that humility in them. And the nearest one you can go is to Queensway. This is not Queensway, this is Nira. So you can come to it here, inshallah. So please help them. Second thing, please, if you can volunteer. Believe me, a lot of people think charity work is by giving money. Money is one thing. And money is in the hand of Allah. Whether you give it or not, that's something else. But Allah gives. But giving your time from yourself, because you control your own time and your own energy. Volunteering is the best thing you can do. Volunteering to help the helpless, volunteering to help the elderly, volunteering to help the illiterate to be learning, the one who want to understand certain subject is really important. Maybe you know how to teach the Quran properly. You can volunteer to teach some people Quran. Maybe you like to discuss with children. You can have like a storytelling session. Anything you can volunteer to do or even help the homeless people who come to eat here. Every day there is activity. And now inshallah, once they lift everything, this place will be busy. Before the lockdown, at least 2,000 people come a week here. And I used to see sometimes Saturday and Sunday here, it's packed. And up to 45 different groups or more, they come to utilize the space, doing different things. So the more volunteers we have, it's better. If you are not a volunteer, for Allah's sake, put your name and become a volunteer. Because wallahi, the reward you get out of it is you can't imagine. I can't tell you. And it is absolute the satisfaction you get. We have a woman who works with us called Galaida. I don't know whether she's here today or not. But Galaida is a Christian, Catholic, Filipino who lived in London. She came to volunteer in our kitchen in Willis and Green. And her only hope that one day this will grow up and she can have a job. And guess what? Because she was thinking like that, a year later, Allah opened for us to get some help to pay people's salaries from a big organization. And we increase our staff, and I said to her, she can have a job. And she was so grateful. She lives with us as if she's a Muslim. She does more dhikr than the Muslims. She reads every day, La ilaha illallah, 3,000 times. Which of us sitting here read La ilaha illallah 3,000 times every day? She's Christian. People want to push her to become Muslim. Leave her as it is. Allah knows what he's doing to her. Yeah, because Allah's controlling the heart. So volunteer, this is number two for you. And finally, although yani, the restriction are not being lifted yet, all the laws that are being prescribed by the government, locally or nationally, please be obliged to follow them. If you are offered to have the vaccination, take it. I have already taken, alhamdulillah, my two vaccinations. there are some clever clocks using Iblis tools, going around telling them not to use it. Ma'arifay, it is only to put people down. It is a way ma'arif to control life of people. What a nonsense. What a nonsense. I am sitting in front of you here. 3-4 years ago, I went to Tanzania to apply for the visa. The Tanzanian government have yellow fever in their country. They asked me, I can't enter the country until I have a yellow fever, immunization, and typhoid. So I have to go and find a private doctor. He gave it to me. I paid him some money. And in the airport, I had a passport for those two vaccinations. The first thing they asked me, have you got the vaccination? Because they want to save their people. And when they want to save me, not bring the disease back here. This is sunnah of Rasulullah. If you know the disease in a place, don't enter it. And if you are in it, don't leave it. Today, people don't want to follow the rules. Why am I wearing a mask? I took my vaccination. But because if you didn't take your vaccination, okay, maybe I'm carrying it, I can give it to you. Please be careful. And it is a selfish way of people saying, no, I'm not doing the vaccination. I don't want to do it. Or I'm not going to wear my mask. What? Don't think of yourself. Think of others. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخي ما يحب لنفسه. None of you can claim to be a believer until you love for your brother or sister what you love for yourself. Would you love to see yourself sick? Would you love to see yourself not able to breathe in a hospital? I went to hospital during the pandemic. I went to St. Mary's. I had a problem Allah wanted to show me because I was hearing all those things. I had a really bad shoulder. And my doctors were worried because my heart was unable to function properly. They were really worried, what's wrong with me? So they said, immediately go to hospital. During the pandemic, I went there, I promise you by Allah, I had never seen a scene more frightening than what I see. It was like a war zone. No, usually you go to hospital, people welcome you, people take your name. Here, everyone is running under the police, and there is, because people were fighting, people were angry, people on the floor. I was absolutely shocked. In Britain, in London, in St. Mary's, in center of London, next to the government, this is happening. And one of the people said to me, here it is better, there are other places even worse. During the rough time, when it was really bad. You don't know. A lot of people talk nonsense. Many people died. And what they tell you how many died is not the real numbers. Too many died. Somebody might say, oh, their time has come. Of course their time has come. But the disease became the reason for their death. Do not throw yourself for death. Do not throw yourself. Allah said, do not kill yourself. So why are you killing people? So please listen to this advice because it is important. We Muslims should be exemplars. Anybody whom you hear sending messages saying, no, don't take it, this, don't do that, repel them straight away, but in a nice way. Don't swear at them, don't tell them a bad name, don't tell them you don't understand. No, just say, brother, sister, thank you for your advice, but the Prophet's advice is this. What I told you, just tell them, and Allah will look after you. May Allah bless you all. Nice to see you. I'm sorry if it is too long, but we'll see you soon. Look into the Rumi's website. There will be a lot of activities. One of the best activities we want to do, inshallah, after this is lifted, in the end of August, we're going to have the biggest fun night. Inshallah. It's going to be a comedy night. One of the greatest comedians have offered himself for free. He's not a Muslim. He's Iranian. Maybe you know him. His name is Omid. Okay? Omid, what's his surname?
Jalili.
Omid Jalili. Maybe you know, he's a very big actor. He does, at the moment, he does a program in ITV. He came here once. A friend of mine is also his friend, a very good Pakistani brother called Fahim Mazhari, who used to feed the poor people every Friday here. He cooked it at home and bring it. Yeah. So when he died and we did a remembrance night for him, Omid came and I spoke before Omid and then I introduced him. So I said things made Omid laugh. And he came to me to give me a hug. He said to me, I'm the comedian. You have taken my place. I start laughing when you're talking. And he asked me what you do, and I really like what you do here. This, and explained to him everything. He said, if you need me for anything. So we told him we want to make, after this pandemic is lifted, want to have a nice fundraising night, but comedy. Nice. He agreed. And it's a very good thing, inshallah. If a non-Muslim can do that, Allahu Akbar. So our Muslim has to stand up, and we really do this for Allah. Nothing else. We want Allah to make us. I wish one day in London you see a lot of the young Muslims walking about in their afternoon, in their morning, looking at under bridges, under tunnels, and seeing the homeless lying there, sitting with them, holding their hand, giving them food. That will make me the happiest person. Because this is what Allah wants us to do. sitting with people and not inviting them to Islam by reading the Quran for them, by just behaving as Muslims. Seeing a woman with a pram, helping her, seeing an old person in the bus or the train, getting up for them, seeing somebody with shopping, going and helping them, seeing somebody not being able to climb the stairs, driving your car and seeing an elderly person or a family pushing and it is raining, you stop, give them a lift. That is Islam. If you can do that, Allah will help you. Shukran, jazakumullah khair. See you soon, inshallah. What's